convene meeting of the Northampton School Committee. I'm Mayor David Narkowitz, and I'm chairing the meeting. And we'll begin by asking the clerk to call the roll of the school committee.
Present.
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 Here.
Here.
Sends his regrets.
I don't think he's here. I don't think he comes to meetings anymore.
Present.
Okay. Yes, I'm here.
Sorry.
Okay, so we do have a quorum. We can proceed. So the first item on our agenda is the public comment period, and we have one person signed up this evening, Steve Harrell. Steve, if you can, as always, just identify your address, name and address for the record.
Sure.
And
she's not even here. It's tonight. It's great. My name is Steve Harrell, and I live at 474 Elm Street. Perhaps you know that the Massachusetts Association of School Committees this last week passed this resolution submitted by the Newton School Committee. These are excerpts. Whereas the Center for Disease Control recognizes insufficient sleep in adolescents significantly affects their academic success. Therefore, be it resolved that the Massachusetts Association of School Committees be authorized to petition the legislature and to support legislation which calls for the establishment of a special It cited significant risks that come from lack of sleep, including higher rates of obesity and depression and motor vehicle accidents among teens. The lead author said, quote, getting enough sleep is important for students' health, safety, and academic performance, end quote. There are serious efforts afoot in many Massachusetts districts to change start times, including Newton, Melrose, Falmouth, Natick, Canton, Burlington, Hudson, Weston, Middleborough, Andover, and a number of others. But it's not just in our state. This very September, the Fairfax, Virginia public schools next to DC have successfully delayed the start time at their 22 high schools by 40 minutes. In nearby Loudoun County in Virginia, high schools now start at 9 o'clock and let out at 10 minutes to 4. The Decatur, Alabama schools have just pushed back start times for middle and high school students to 8:30. Another Alabama district has delayed start times by 1 hour and 15 minutes to 9 a.m. There's a district in California which is working on a flexible start time program wherein various students may choose to begin between 7:30 and 9:30. That's something creative we could look at. Also in California, Bakersfield Christian High School has delayed by 30 minutes to 8:30, quote, in order to improve academic performance. In Colorado, Montezuma Cortez School District delayed the high school start time by 90 minutes to 9 a.m. And in Florida, the Bay District Schools reset their 5 high school start times to between 8:15 and 8:45. At another district in Florida, they delayed the middle and high school start time by 1 hour and 10 minutes to 8:45. This is just a small sample of what's going on all around us. If they can do it, we can do it, and we must. Thank you.
Thank you, Steve.
Thank you.
Okay, there's no one else who's signed up. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in the public comment that didn't sign up? Okay, hearing none, we'll move on to any announcements from school committee members. Ms. Duvall.
Yeah, I just want to remind people that until November 30th, the Cedar Chest has nice scarves. They're $10. All of the proceeds go to the Northampton High School PTO and the JFK PTO, split right down the middle. So it's a great Christmas gift, and it's until November 30th. And also, just to remind you all that the PTOs play a very important part in our schools. So just to make sure you sign up and so you know what's happening and if you can support them, because supporting them supports us, the school, our budget, the technology, because PTOs are really helpful. So thank you to the PTOs, and please buy a scarf. Thank you.
Any other announcements from school committee members? Yes, Ms. Nakarchuk.
I would like to announce that this is going to be my final school committee meeting. As you all know, I was not reelected, which I'm disappointed about, but taking it in stride as best I can. And I am not going to be able to make the December meeting. So I would like to thank all of the committee members, the mayor and the superintendent for a wonderful experience. I have truly learned a lot and plan to run again someday, probably when my kids are a little bit older and I have a little more time to dedicate to a campaign. And other than that, thank you to everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other announcements? Mr. Zahowski.
As many of you are aware, on Tuesday, October 27, 2015, we lost Mr. James Dostal. Mr. Dostal was a 10-year school committee member, as well as a Northampton City Council member for 10 years. In his obituary, it was said, Jim Dostal was the kind of person who, simply by innate tendencies, affected his environment with pure positivity. His confidence, generosity, and sense of humor were only three of a host of attributes that made up a man whose goal was simple, to help every single person he met in whatever way he could. I thought it would be fitting this evening, in honor of Mr. James Dostal, if we would just have a moment of silence. Thank you. I speak for so many people whose lives were touched by Mr. James Dostal, mine included. He really was there in so many ways to help me understand local politics and what it is to be a true representative of this city. So I'm forever grateful to his guidance. Thank you.
Ditto for me on that one.
Yeah.
Anyone else want to make any announcements? Okay, so we'll move into recommended actions. We do have a consent agenda this evening. I just want to be clear, are we pulling any of these? Okay, these are all clear. Okay, good. So we have on the consent agenda this evening, we have the minutes of the school committee meeting of October 8th, 2015. We then have a series of field trip requests, the NHS academic team, pre-holiday academic tournament in South Burlington, Vermont, December 4th and 5th of 2015. We've got the NHS outing club going to Mohawk Trail State Forest in Charlemont, February 5th through the 7th, 2016. We've got the 8th grade chorus students going to New York City, April 6, 2016. Ryan Road 5th grade to the Connecticut Science Center in Hartford, April 28, 2016. The 8th grade Latin students going to New York City, May 5, 2016. 8th grade Spanish students going to New York City, May 5, 2016. The 8th grade French students going to Quebec City in Quebec, Canada, May 27th through the 29th, 2016. And then a preliminary approval for an NHS students going to Ireland, tentatively April vacation, 2017. If I could have a motion on the consent agenda.
Motion to approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. All those in favor of approving the consent agenda, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, the consent agenda is approved. We now move into reports and recommendations, and we have another field trip. This is one that we are going to hear some information about. This is a field trip, the NHS a cappella and chamber choir going to Montreal, Quebec, April 8th through the 10th, 2016. And I believe Beau is here to talk about that this evening.
I am, yes. Well, hello. Thanks for having me. Good evening. We are hoping that we can take the chamber choir and the Northamptons April 8th through 10th. I don't know if you all have the itineraries with you to Montreal. The first day we arrive, we would perform in the Basilica. in the center of Montreal, and then have a day of festivities and fun and evening concert. And then the next day, we would go to Concordia University and do a workshop with a well-known conductor who's a professor of choral music at McGill in Concordia. And so it's a two-day event, and then we would come home the third day. So sort of a quick trip to Montreal. 35 students.
Questions from any school committee members? Okay. Sounds like a great great experience for them.
Yeah.
Okay.
Motion to approve the field trip to Montreal.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion about approving this trip? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. You're approved. The next is a vote on a field trip to Barcelona and Madrid, Spain. That's April 12th through the 19th, 2017. And I believe Principal Lombardi is here.
Good evening, everybody. Proposal for a trip to Barcelona and Madrid for 2017. And other chaperones would be Sandy Cabasa and Courtney Woodruff. This would be our third trip together. And feedback from parents was to try to get the information out there more in advance for people who had more time to think about and sign up. So this is our notification to get the ball rolling for this type of trip for April 2017.
Okay.
Can you answer any questions you have?
Yeah. Any questions from?
What happens if Barcelona ends up being in Catalonia instead?
Yes, I know that they did pass that to secede and form. We'll see what happens. I believe the EU is not supporting that, so I think there'll be a lot of pressure to stay within proper Spain and the EU.
Okay.
I noticed that you're going.
Yes.
I'm envious.
It's a good trip. Yeah, I've done two trips with Sandy and Ms. Kilbasa and Ms. Woodruff. We're a good team. Nice rapport, and we think we benefit the students. We did Spain 2 years ago. Actually, last spring, I'm sorry.
Okay. Any other questions or comments about the trip? If not, I'd entertain a motion to
approve the trip to Barcelona and Madrid from April 12th to the 19th.
Thank you.
Second.
2017.
Okay. So there's been a motion made and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay.
Thank you. Approval.
Next item on the agenda is a report from our student representative, Kyle O'Connell. Kyle, the floor is yours.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Kyle O'Connell, and I will be serving as one of the senior student representatives for the coming academic year. First quarter grades closed for students this past Tuesday, November 10th. Report cards will be going out in home base on Tuesday, November 17th. The NHS Key Club will be hosting a student dodgeball tournament on Friday, November 20th at 6 p.m. in the gym. There will be free ice cream and music. There is no cost, however, participants are asked to bring canned food to donate. There is a mandatory preseason winter meeting for coaches, parents, and student athletes Tuesday, December 8th, 2015 in the NHS Auditorium. Last night, the girls' varsity field hockey team played in the Division I Western Mass Finals, placing second overall, so congratulations to them. Picture Retake Day will be held in the auditorium this Monday, the 16th. On December 16th, the 18th Annual Poetry Slam will take place at NHS. This wildly popular event provides students with a safe space to showcase their creativity, as well as encouraging young poets through optional workshops in the weeks before the event. Senior photos and baby pictures are due by November 24th. Upcoming college visits at the high school include on Friday, November 13th, Western New England University, Wednesday, November 18th, Culinary Institute of America, Thursday, November 19th, Castleton State College, and Friday, November 20th, the University of Hartford. Did you know that every 2 seconds somewhere in the U.S. needs blood? There will be a blood drive at the high school on Wednesday, November 18th from 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. Students over the age of 16 are eligible to donate. And finally, the senior float was a big hit this year for Booster Week Parade. Spearheaded by class co-president Dan Averill, the excellent recreation of the Hogwarts Express and Station House, earned the class of 2016 their third float contest win and resulted in a first place overall for Booster Week.
Excellent. Thank you for that report. The next item on the agenda is the personnel report, and we'll turn to the business administrator, or actually John.
Sure. I'm going to introduce just one person to the committee tonight. As you know, back in August, the city was able to obtain a grant to allow us to restore the position of school resource officer to our district. And Chief Casper, when she was still Captain Casper, was good enough to involve me in interviews for that position. I have to tell you that Josh Wallace, who's here tonight, who I would like to introduce to you, really impressed me in the interview process. Actually, you know, as far as I was concerned, he had the job from the first sentence when he told me that his parents were teachers. He really is interested in helping kids make good choices, and I think he's been a very good presence in our schools and in our extracurricular activities. You know that I've been sharing some communications with you regarding our efforts to make sure that kids make good choices at football games, and I have to tell you, one of the most sort of heartwarming experiences of my first semester was the final Agawam football game, where Josh was like right in this scrum of kids, just enjoying the game with them. And I think, you know, you can see that he's a presence, and having him next to you, I think, makes you want to make good choices if you're a high school student. So Josh Wallace, our SRO.
Stand up, Josh. You want to say a few words at the podium? Just introduce yourself to the public? Okay. We have a 3-minute rule, though, officer. Keep that,
got it.
Keep that in mind.
I just want to say thank you for inviting me to meet everyone on the school committee. It, like Dr. Provost said, both my parents are now retired teachers, so I kind of grew up in that academic atmosphere, and I'm able to bounce some things off them now when problems come across my plate that I'm not sure how to handle with a inside of school. I'm able to use them as a resource, so that's very valuable to me. It is very important to me that I'm involved in the students' lives, and I try to do that in every aspect that I can at the school, joining them in chorus class, or, you know, visiting the culinary arts students, or, you know, the alternative learning program, and working on projects with them. Just getting to know them and build the trust with the students is something that I'm really striving to do, and I think I'm doing a good job at it. But I want to thank you guys for inviting me today. And
can we ask questions?
Sure.
Absolutely.
What percentage of your time you're spending at the high school versus have you been at JFK, and then also have you been at the elementary schools, and if so, what have you done? And just like expand on them, not like a specific question, just in general.
So right now, the grant that funds my position is written written specifically for Northampton High School. So administratively, I'm able to assist staff members and students from other schools. As far as hands-on stuff, the only thing I do at other schools are coordinating the lockdown safety drills, fire drills, things like that. I spend probably 98% of my time at Northampton High School.
And with all of the restraint holds, and are you trained to restrain? I mean, as far as the schools go, the restraining, we're going to be voting on that, I guess, but are you?
Right. So I think the school uses a CPI, which is a school of restraint that I was certified in probably 8 years ago when I worked for Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center. But then through the Massachusetts Police Training Committee, you know, through my police academy, I am trained to restrain. However, that is the farthest choice of option for me.
I'm sure having teachers for parents, like you said, you can go and bounce it off and figure out better ways, but thank you very much.
My background for the police department is in crisis intervention. I'm a certified crisis negotiator for the FBI. So talking,
you can handle teenagers?
Talking is my strong point. Am I over my 3? Is that
okay? What's that?
Was that
I heard that was in my... That was in my Any other questions for Officer Wallace? Well, thank you. Thank you for being here tonight, and thank you for the work you're doing.
Thank
Thank you.
Okay, we'll continue with the personnel report.
The rest of it you've got in front of you. This was during the month of October. We had 6 hirings, mostly in our preschool program, 3 separations, 3 transfers within the school department, and 1 retirement that actually took place a couple weeks ago of Susan Goddard, an ESP at JFK Middle School, and she actually worked for the district for 20 years before her retirement.
Okay, thank you very much. Any questions about the personnel report? Okay, so now we'll move into some presentations from our district administrators of school improvement plans. And so the first one on the agenda is Principal Cannata presenting for Leeds Elementary.
Good evening, everybody. It's always a pleasure to be here. I mean that. So I will be reasonably brief in my presentation. Because the document that you have before you really isn't a really large, lengthy document. But I think before I say anything about the document, or actually since this is directly about the document, the theory of action kind of speaks to what we've been trying to accomplish at Leeds the last few years. And that is to build teacher consistency. And I mean that with regard to turnover. We've had very little turnover. And with regard to their professional development, with regard to their training, so that they're all on the same page at grade level and school-wide, and also the efforts of the district so that we're all on the same page district-wide. One of the big pushes has been and continues to be increasing family and community engagement, which has had a resulting effect in a very improved school climate. And while it's not out there yet, I believe that these three things, the teacher consistency, the family and community engagement, and the climate is starting to show through very strongly in our test scores and in our assessments, and I hope that we can continue on that same path. The document itself has 3 goals, and this is the first time I presented a school improvement plan for Leeds, and it's really the first time in my time that I was there that we had a real school council. It took a little bit and it took a while to build it up, and I'm just coming from my meeting where I had 14 people in front of me a few minutes ago. To anyone who sat on a school council before, to have 5 teachers, 5 or 5 staff members, 5 members of the council, and then other people there just because it's an open meeting is a pretty good feeling, and I'm coming to you with a good feeling. So that being said, we as a school council, since we were brand new, we said let's look at the district improvement plan and let's look at the 2015-2016 work plan and align it as closely as possible as we could. And since these are things that are happening, we went along with that. So the first one, pretty simple, and it's probably going to be very similar to my colleagues, that is to improve and implement the RTI plan, which is happening throughout the district, ensuring that our students are being screened properly. And not only being screened, but that the data is looked into as deep as we can, and then we use that data to try to figure out how to remediate, how to offer different things for kids who need a little bit more, try to support those kids who may need a little bit of help. So with that, we've created a data team who analyzes the data and works with their grade level colleagues and within the school to try to figure out proper interventions for students. That's our first goal, and I can tell you, and I'm sure the rest of my colleagues would tell you, it's been a pretty big undertaking, and it will happen over time. The second goal is probably one that I'm glad is a part of my school improvement plan, because it's something that I believe pretty strongly in. While none of the goals is greater than the other, this is, to me, is the most important one, and it's about cultivating the unified mindset, which to me is about communicating both internally and externally to the community. So a couple of the highlights within this, and you may not think about this during the course of the school day, but one of the very first bullet statement I have there is about the ESPs. And you know, ESPs are pretty integral to the running of our building. They really are where the rubber meets the road in many cases. But because of their work hours, it's often hard to communicate with them. So one of the things we worked on was to ensure that we have coverage at least once a month after the ALT meeting and after our faculty meeting, that I'm able to meet with the ESP, so there is no there's no questions or secrets. It's all about transparency from top down and bottom up. So that's part of the internal communication. Other things which are going to continue, weekly and monthly communications by using newsletters, email bullets that we do with through our PTO, use of the, I'm going to say robocall, but school messenger. And one of the beautiful things that's happened with this mindset is we took on volunteerism as a pledge drive, both at the school council level and at the PTO level. Like I said, I had 14 people at a school council meeting a little while ago, and our PTO is very, very strong. Broadening that out a little bit further, as far as utilizing external resources, we are pursuing grants, both through the Mass Cultural Council and the NEF, one of which is really started last Thursday, where part of it, one of the NEF grants was to reach out to the Meadowbrook community. And over the past 3 weeks, we had a bus go there and bring families, give them an opportunity to get on the bus and come to open house, which was nice for some people didn't have transportation. And last Thursday, we started our community outreach, and we had a wonderful first night. We have plans for math, robotics, and maybe some potluck. I don't know. We'll see. But it was very well received, and it only promises to get bigger. And lastly, there's several things here. One of the things that we were just working on and are trying to figure out how to gauge school climate, we're working on a survey and trying to figure out how our stakeholders are receiving us as a school, if we're reaching everybody. And again, we're banging that out right now. That was part of the discussion that I just came from. Finally, looks kind of funny on paper, but it's to ensure at least 75% engagement with parents and guardians at all the many different things that we have to offer. This is a solid list of things that Leeds currently does. There's a couple start events on there that Leeds is going to take on, and we are hoping to get at least 75% of all of our families, parents, guardians engaged in some way, shape, or form within the community. And anticipating a question, how am I going to measure that? Actually going to be pretty easy. What we've done is we take a classroom list, a homeroom list, and with a highlighter, whenever someone comes to one of these events, I have the teacher simply putting the highlight through the teacher name or through the student name. At the end of the year, we'll be able to add them up and see how we do, and I look forward to that that percentage. I do want to make one addition to the list you have on there. If you could put field day down, Leeds has an incredible field day that we'd like to see more parents engaged at and volunteering at. That's all I got.
Are there any questions for Principal Cannata regarding the Leeds School Improvement Plan?
I just have a quick support you in the efforts to make the school council be a viable, meaningful body. It's one of those things that's sort of been around for 25 years in this statute, but hasn't always been sort of brought to life in schools, and I think it has to be.
It was pretty good. Like I said, there was 14, and for those of us who work in school, there was 4 men sitting there tonight. it was unique and a cool experience, and the co-chair who was elected tonight pointed it out.
I would like to commend you for the community involvement that I've seen over in your schools, from the way that you had an open house at the beginning and fill up the auditorium and even say goodbye to them. And you made a very cute hot dog on Halloween Day.
Thanks. And on TV, thanks.
Yeah, and I was just really impressed at the number of participants, the community members that came out at what, 11:30 in the morning, was it that we went? I mean, it was one. I'm not quite sure what time it was, but it was just really nice, a lot of fun, and it was nice that you invited the community. And I think that you're the only elementary school that invites the community for the Halloween event. I may be wrong, but I don't recall it. I remember pots and pans or something at Ryan Road, but not inviting the community, and I just thought that was really nice. So, thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Cannata. Okay, the next presentation of School Improvement Plan is Principal Madden from Ryan Road Elementary School.
I'm probably going to talk less than Sal. Typically, that's the way it is, right, Sal? I just wanted to thank everybody who was involved in the planning of the District Improvement Plan. I really appreciated the collaborative process of the district planning, which has led to, I think, a much greater unified vision for our district. And so it was helpful as our school council met together to try to come up with our school improvement plan. And we did, our goals are perfectly aligned, but I really appreciated the collaboration and getting so many people involved in the district plan, so it didn't seem like it was something that was just created out of somebody's thoughts, but all sorts of our thoughts from all sorts of constituents. So that was great. So the goals are completely, the first goals are aligned. The first is the response to intervention. The second is cultivating a unified mindset, and the third is developing our data systems. And I have to say that I'm mostly grateful to sort of our village of adults at Ryan Road School, because it is the community that really is working hard to respond to the varied needs of our students. Our population has changed over the last several years at Ryan Road, and we have, you know, a good number of needs, of high needs and low needs and all sorts of needs, and we're working on early intervention and responding to those needs in as many ways as we can. Our students are involved. We have a student leadership team that is quite an energetic group. Lots of creative ideas about how to bring spirit and enthusiasm into our school. We have an instructional leadership team that works very well together in terms of leading staff meetings and looking at data and trying to drive our plan in a good systematic way. We meet together monthly to as a whole school community to make sure that we're reminding ourselves about what is good about our community, and that's always been a nice, we celebrate the seasons too, but we also do monthly. That must be the pot banging that you remember. It must have been a seasonal celebration, Blue.
It was.
Yeah.
Just for the kindergartners. They went around in all the classrooms banging.
Oh, that could have been for Halloween. Yes, our seasonal celebration for the first day of winter. I think everybody bangs something.
Yeah, and then they get together outside.
Yes.
Yeah, no, this was just kindergartners.
Yes. Does anybody have any questions about the plan?
Any questions about the... Yes.
Well, I don't really have a question as much as a comment. I went away to Hyannis last week for the conference, and one of the things that they were talking about is the responsive classroom and how social and emotional learning, it's a wonderful, can't think of the word, but model. And I like what your school is doing with that, and I also like very much what it does, what you do with the Spanish night and the Hispanic night and the Cambodian dance and everything else. And so that's when I really thought about you a lot last week when they were talking about that, and I'm hoping that maybe some of the responsive classroom ideas can become more pervasive.
Well, that's included in our plan. And I think for our school community, the responsive classroom is vital to everything that we do, and it underlines all of our actions and all of our reactions. And we really work on the power of our words and the effect that our actions have on our community, all of us, as adults and as children, and that's something that I try to model on a daily basis. And with all sorts of trauma, and our response to that is really important to help them be successful at school.
Well, I was at a school council meeting here at JFK, and one thing a couple years ago, I remember when I was at one, they said how nice the kids were and coming out, and then this year, that was the same, I didn't go last year, so I don't know, but this year they said again how nice the kids are coming out of all the different elementary schools, and I think we're doing something really right, and I'd like to see the responsive classroom, you know, be used more, shared more.
It really underlies all that we do, and it is important. And I think my overarching hope at the top there I'm just going to read it. Our overarching hope is that Ryan Road School is a place where children laugh and enjoy learning, where they want to come to school, where they continually gain skills, character, and confidence, and where they feel supported by a strong and caring learning community. So if we do that, we're doing all right.
Thank you.
Yes.
I just want to point out for the people who don't have the documents in front of them, how many of these great activities are on the liaison for the Northampton Education Foundation, mm-hmm. and how many of these community outreach programs, art education projects, mm-hmm. the artist residency programs, there's so much.
Outreach to Florence Heights is also supported by.
Right, yeah. So they're supporting so much in our schools, and I feel like a lot of people are unaware that mm-hmm. some of the most innovative programs that our district offers are actually funded by the Northampton mm-hmm. Education Foundation, so I'm so glad that you included that.
Yes. Incredible resource.
Mr. Meyer.
So I had a question because the RTI was a Lee's goal as well. So the universal screening is something that you're putting in place, and obviously that's an overlay on what teachers already do in terms of screening kids. And I'm just wondering about resources available for tier two interventions, because obviously that's not the special education apparatus, but that's a commitment of sort of new and different kind of resources that I think are always harder or hard to put in place because they're not necessarily legally mandated, but yet they can be so effective. And I wonder if you could just address how you're going to put those resources in place and maintain them.
Well, we've got a great Title I team at Ryan Road. We have Beth Brady doing math and Mary Beth O'Connor doing reading, and they're a fabulous duo. I feel blessed every day. And we have done a great job with our assessments, not just the new assessments that we've done, which are really just a quick red flag for us to see whether we need to delve a little bit more deeply, but also the formative and daily assessments that teachers are doing. We're meeting on a regular basis to try to address the needs of our students. I'll be honest and say there are more needs than we have than we have staff. You know, when we looked at all the assessments that we've done in the fall and looked at the needs of our students, we're not addressing everybody. You know, we had our cutoff criteria and we're not reaching all of those students. So, you know, we had to make decisions based on our best interests and based on the data, but we're not reaching everybody. And so we're, you know, classroom teachers are having to do a lot of differentiation in the classroom, but we're doing the best we can and we're gonna see how it goes, but we're not reaching all the kids who made, you know, that cut with our assessments. So questioning that is a good thing.
But the conversation obviously is going on at the district level, how obviously resources are always tight, but how to find those. Because the model, I think the model to do the screening is the first step, but the model can, I guess, know the models, we've been pushing this for a while, and I know a lot of districts have been, but actually freeing up the resources to, like you said, not just address the kids who are in the greatest need, but sort of all kids who would benefit is the ideal. But
we're certainly focusing on early intervention in our earlier grades, but that doesn't mean that the older children aren't getting interventions, right. But more of the Title I work is happening in first and second grade at this point, really trying to hope that putting a lot of work in at this point will help those students to succeed by third grade, and certainly read by third grade and be able to understand numeracy. Mm-hmm. So that's our hope.
Dr. Provost?
I would also just add that this is the first year we've done universal screening for academic and social and emotional problems in the early grades. And so it's the first time we've had an opportunity to quantify need that is sort of less than special ed,
right,
but still need. So I think that does sort of inform where we need to go next. Ryan Road is not the only school, the only elementary school that was not able to get as far as they would like to have gotten with their interventionists. Actually, in most of the schools, grades K1 and 2 and 3, to a certain extent, took up all the slots the interventionists had available. So, you know, it does, hopefully, as Ms. Madden said, those kids, many of them will be able to get back on the right track and won't need ongoing support. But it does point to maybe an inadequate level of support for kids who fall sort of in that middle ground between solidly doing okay in regular ed and really needing special ed.
Right.
And it was also very interesting to look at the strengths and difficulties questionnaire, because we hadn't done any sort of universal emotional screen. And I actually just printed out all of that data, and I learned more about it than I had known before the weekend, actually, when I was doing that, and that it breaks down social and emotional reports into categories. So sort of overall concerns, hyperactivity, conduct issues, peer problems, and how some students would really pop up for conduct problems and emotional, but not at all for another area. And so all the teachers now have those reports, and we're trying to think about how best to, in meeting with grade levels on Friday, not tomorrow, but next Friday, sort of about, you know, what is this telling us, and what do we need to do, and are there, you know, what interventions can we do based on what we're seeing here? So I think we're making headway, but we're just, you know, we're starting with some of this. Not that we've been dealing with certainly kids with all of those issues, but it's interesting to look at it collectively as a school in a kind of a different way.
If there was one thing, I mean, not thinking about money or anything, but if there was one thing that you could think of, oh, all we needed was blah, 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 this would really address the problem.
Oh, boy. I might start drooling.
Just one thing. What would you say?
I said I want to start drooling.
Oh. No, but I mean, is there something that you can think of that you'd say, oh, this is what we need, but...
Boy. I think that because we have such strong teachers who are really good at their craft, I would say we need more emotional support with kids who have trauma in their lives, because a small percentage of students with a high level of trauma can really disrupt a learning environment, not just a classroom, but a school, and certainly can take up a lot of time from me and just and other adults. And I think that really thinking about what these kids who have experienced a lot of trauma need in terms of school success and how to give them what they need without it negatively impacting the other students in the class is something that we're still figuring out.
All right, and then one more question about technology. Has technology at all been an impediment yet in this process, or is it like way out, we're still dealing with much more core issues at this point?
We definitely need more technology, I think.
But I mean, is it creating equity? I mean, inequity is what I'm kind of,
or
is it more like you're still working at identifying?
I don't think technology is, I think we need to increase our tools. So I see us needing to use technology to increase our tools for differentiation. And I don't think we have enough machines at this point to do that. And so that's certainly something that teachers are really ready to do and are eager to do. But we're all trying to use the same Chromebook cart. And so teachers are trying to take some computers off the cart, and another teacher wanted to use the whole class, you know, so that we're just running into a bind in terms of limited amounts of technology when teachers are really ready to grab on to tools that are available.
Thank you. I didn't mean to put you on the spot.
Oh, that's all right.
Other questions or comments for Mr. Zasko?
I had a question in regards to the model around growth mindset for learning that you make reference to. I know that it's kind of a topic that's going around the valley as far as professional development, and I was wondering if you've had any professional development in regards to Carol Dweck's work, or if you're using just certain vocabulary and terms in the school with students from staff, or?
We have. We certainly have talked a lot about grit and perseverance. And so I think I certainly talk to staff and teachers around that idea, but also I hear teachers using that kind of language a lot, that, you know, we're going to make mistakes, we're going to have a hard time, and we've really got to, you know, keep working at this. And it's hard work. School is hard work for a lot of kids, and so it really does require an awful amount of perseverance and grit and understanding and love and food and all sorts of things. But yes, we certainly talk about the ways that we need to keep growing, and even in the ways that our population has changed at Ryan Road. And as a staff, we need to really adjust and figure out what's needed that may be different even from 4 years ago. And so I think we're always talking about growing and not just not always staying the same. Like what worked 5 years ago may not work now. Some of it will, but not all of it. And that's true for kids too. You're in a new grade and there are new strategies and you got to keep at it, but that's really hard. If your life is hard, that's really hard. And how best do we need to help kids to, it's easy to say, keep going, you know, but what do we really need to do to help kids to keep going when their days are hard? Some of our students have really hard days.
Just following up on that concept, I think it's so common for kids, at least in my kids' age group, that they're sugar-coated. Things are sugar-coated for them a lot at home, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. And so I think the grit language and the perseverance language and the you can do it even though it's hard is so needed for kids in the elementary schools. And so I think it's great that you guys are doing.
And I say you're not.
Of course, I'm a little bit biased at school, but that's okay.
And I say, you know, you're not going to like everything you do.
Right. And
you know, I don't like
so
everything
important.
I do every day. But you know, we've got to keep at it. And what do you yep. need? What do you need to get back at it? I'm here to help you, but. You may not love this activity. I hope you love most of what you do in school, but you're not going to love everything.
And that's okay, that but do it anyway.
Yeah.
Okay. Other comments or questions? Thank you very much.
All right, thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, so the next presentation is Principal Wilson from right here at JFK Middle School.
Thank you for having all of us here tonight. And I want to begin by thanking our school council for their hard work and their commitment on behalf of our students and our school community. We certainly always appreciate their insight and perspective and continued efforts to help us improve our school. And this year, like Sal, we have a much bigger council. I think our council has been highly active and efficient and effective. And this year we have now, I believe we have six parent members, six school members. So we look forward to our work together. This plan was actually developed by last year's school council. However, the last year's school council members are also returning. So we look forward as a school council to implementing and supporting this plan together with the new team. I also want to thank the superintendent and the school committee for your support and dedication, and as well the district improvement plan team. That was a really valuable experience for me, and we were really fortunate, those of us who were able to participate in the process. And like everyone else, when developing our school improvement plan, our aim was to align with the district improvement plan. And we did so in the areas of response to intervention, cultivating a unified mindset, and developing data systems. We also felt as a school council it was important to include or to continue to include a technology theory of action. So we have also focused our work in that area as well. So we have our theories of action, and you have the document. Our first theory of action is based on restorative practices. And it states, if we implement restorative practices, we will positively impact school climate and strengthen our JFK community, which in turn will improve learning for all students. We have two goals in this area. And I just want to say that restorative practice is really a natural fit with our commitment in our building to building relationships and community and having students take responsibility for their learning in their school. We're also starting the practice of restorative justice as a component of the restorative practice work we're doing. And this is about moving beyond a focus on rules and instead having a focus on how our behavior impacts those around us. So that is all part of the restorative practices that we are just starting to explore and learn about and implement at JFK. So our first goal in that area is to create and train a leadership team. And our second goal in that area is to educate and engage the faculty and staff. I have to say, we did a faculty meeting presentation. This fall, we are going to be training over 35 faculty with the beginning training, and that was all voluntary. So we have a lot of folks at JFK really interested. A core team of administrators, guidance counselors, and teachers were trained over the summer. And I'm really happy to say that we're looking forward to training educational support professionals in January around the model. And this is really just an introductory piece for our work that we move forward with this year and in the years to come. Our second theory of action is, if we create a system for engaging caregivers and community stakeholders, we will develop shared values and resources to support the academic and social growth of all students. We have two goals in this area. One is to improve outreach and communication with parents and guardians and the community at large. I think that at JFK, this has always been one of the things that we really try to focus on. We are offering many opportunities for parents and guardians and community members to come into our building for events and activities. We've recently run a parent portal workshop. We're also really focusing on website and blogs. Most of our teachers now are using websites or blogs to communicate with students and communicate with families and parents and guardians. And the other part of our goal is to further develop student connections with the community. And We have a grant from the NEF for a day of service, and we're very excited about that. That will be happening in April, and our entire school community. We have not quite figured out the whole organizational piece of this, but we are going to be doing a day of service as a JFK school. We also have many opportunities for students to do community service learning. Much of that comes out of our forum, our advisory, which also connects well back with the restorative practices. And other things that we've done recently and we look forward to doing is our connection with the food bank and Dakin and other community agencies. Our third theory of action is if we strengthen our practice of identifying, analyzing, using relevant data, student data, to inform instruction and decision making, we will increase achievement for all students and accelerate the growth of those farthest behind. I think that our data team is very high functioning, and they're instrumental in being our instructional leaders in this area. Recently, our department chair spent an hour this week on Edwin analyzing our MCAS data and sharing those results out with teachers, and we're using this information to inform our instruction. And all departments in our building develop action plans using data, and they are student-centered, and it's about what's looking at the data and what we want our students to experience in the classroom and learn based on data. So all of our departments will develop and or revise their department action plan for improved student learning outcomes. And finally, technology is our fourth theory of action, and it is if we provide students and teachers with increased access to technology and training, teachers will be better able to differentiate instruction and engage students, resulting in improved student growth and achievement. We have three goals under this theory of action. This is an ambitious plan. We are going to continue to offer the high quality professional development for teachers focused on integrating technology into instruction. We're also looking to locate additional sources to fund technology to provide more access for students and teachers. The NEF has been instrumental in supporting much of our work with technology. They have sponsored a summer camp for teachers for the last 2 years, and also helped us with our instruction, purchasing Chromebooks for our special ed teachers and other teachers in the building. Goal three, I think, is something that we've added that is new, and I think it's really important. And we're going to study, when we're purchasing, we're going to identify the type of technology that will have the greatest impact on student learning. So we really want to be planful in our purchases, both research-based within our school and, you know, in other educational areas, and make sure that we really are, with the limited resources that we have, purchasing the technology that we're going to get the most effective use out of. So that's our school improvement plan.
Do we have questions or comments from school committee members? Sorry, Ms. Fallon.
I misunderstood her. Could you elaborate on the using current data? The departments have developed their department action plan. What data are we looking at besides the MCAS scores?
We'd be looking at our benchmark data as well. So a lot of the departments are using end of the unit assessments. They're using common benchmarks across grade levels. Our district determined measures will be something. We're also looking at data such as nurse visits and attendance and office referrals and things like that. So we're really, as a data team, trying to focus on many sources of data. But the departments with their action plans are primarily going to be using the assessment data, you know, that I spoke of first in MCAS. You know, for example, the history department's data department action plan is focused on citing text evidence. And so looking at our language arts MCAS data and some of our other assessments, that's one of the areas that we really want to focus on. So the history department has developed their action plan based on citing text evidence. You know, math is dividing for actions. And so they're really student-centered and student-focused. The students will be able to, as a result of this. And we're determining what it is our goal is based on the standards and based on the assessment data that we have. Yeah.
So it's by department rather than by team?
Yes. So the math department, the English department. And it's something that all departments are doing. So it's very interesting when we talk about our specials. And so the department chairs all sat together last week and looked at MCAS and discussed some of our MCAS data and some of the other data that they're using. And we developed 4-hour specials, areas that they could focus their department action plan on that would help support the academic success of our students. So it's really kind of a school-wide thing. Test-taking skills was one of the things, open response. So everybody is doing an action plan. Yeah.
Other questions or comments for Principal Wilson? Ms. Minnick.
Broken record, but
I was waiting.
Thank you again. I feel like I have to say it because you do such a great job of community service learning opportunities for your students. So thank you for that.
We're very excited about our day of service, and we're going to ask that you join us because I know it's so important to you. It's great.
I have a question for you. Technology, you were talking about that. I mean, adding that as a goal, and great, congratulations, thank you. But my question is, have you discussed about setting up some sort of guidelines for kids bringing in their own devices or being able to access them, or setting up some sort of protocol, presenting policy, anything along those lines so we can, you know,
we're working on it.
Resources.
You know, and we've discussed it briefly at school council, and we've discussed it at PTO. I think it's something that we really need to be kind of aware of, who has access to bring devices in and who doesn't. I think we need to, you know, make sure that we're thoughtful in how we're using the technology in our instruction, and making sure that all the students have the opportunity, whether it's here or if we're assigning things outside. So we have started to talk about that. We're actually having monthly technology meetings now with our with Angelo Rota, our IT person, and the technology department, the computer folks here at JFK, and that will be one of our conversations. Mm-hmm. At this point, we've really limited the access for students to bring in their own devices, although we do have a policy if they do bring their own device that they need to sign, just like teachers, everybody in the building. And so right now, it's really been limited to students who need the technology for their academics, per like an IEP or a 504 or something like that. But we also, students have been bringing their own devices to the library for free time for reading and things like that. And so we're slowly starting to figure out how we're going to roll it out. We also want to make sure that everything is working within the building before we really jump into it.
Also, how is it going with the teachers' training on the technology? I mean, with the new push on technology, it seems like everybody would have to kind of be on a similar page to know how to use them.
Right.
How's that going?
It's terrific. Over the last 3 or 4 years, we have done so much in the building. Our tech integration specialist and our two computer teachers are just really fantastic, and they give up a lot of their time to help teachers. We've done things at our faculty meeting. Last month at the faculty meeting, we did how to integrate the technology standards to all teachers. It was a presentation that our integration specialist did. So we're working on integrating the 4 technology standards for all teachers and how to do that. Molly does tech tips almost weekly, and she runs workshops after school at faculty meetings, and then she meets regularly with teachers in the building. I have to say that everybody's getting really, really good at using the technology. When I visit classrooms and walk around, it's really commonplace now to see kids on computers or teachers using technology in the building, which creates another issue, is we're really struggling with how to equally give teachers access to the Chromebook carts and the iPad cart and all that, because everybody just really wants to use it, and which is terrific, you know.
The only other thing I wanted to say is I agree with Lisa, and I want to commend you on the community service work that you're incorporating prior to them getting to the Key Club or anything. And that day of service is exciting, but don't you also have kids doing things in forums right now throughout the year? I mean, just...
Yes. We have a cats club and we have a dogs club, and they're working with the local shelters to raise funds and food and blankets and all those things. We just did a UNICEF collection at Halloween. The food bank came in and they talked about the need for supporting families and people in the community with food. And so they did a movie and a presentation with the food bank. So we've really focused on kind of giving back to the community and understanding the community.
Well, I really commend you on the work that you've done, because I think that's the heart of the school, and I've seen how it brings people together and the kids together and the excitement, and I just think that it's wonderful what you're doing, and so thank you very, very much.
Last year, I meant to say we did the Foster Dignity. The entire school did a thing for Foster Dignity, collecting suitcases, and so that was the Day of Service is our school-wide event this year.
Well, and that was also what brought Foster Dignity brought awareness, I think, to a very important issue and about foster kids and not being throwaway and deserving to have the best of everything too. And I think that was really, really important. And for myself personally, after I adopted kids that were in the foster for 5 years, and I know what it's like for them, and I think that it's wonderful what you did, and it was so supportive beyond this community.
Well, that was led by the students in one forum group, and they brought it to the whole school, so we can thank their forum teacher and our seventh grade students who really felt that was important. So, yeah. In the Day of Service, we're connecting with the Senior Center as well as other area agencies. So. Thank you.
Thank you, Principal Wilson. Okay, the final presentation is from the Northampton High School Improvement Plan, and again, we'll hear from Principal Lombardi.
Hello again. Good to be up here. So similar to my peers in regards to the development of the school improvement plan, I do want to thank my department chairs, my teachers, and my school council who have been part of the development of this. I'd also like to thank Superintendent Provost for the opportunity to be involved in the development of the district improvement plan. It was really the first time as my time here as administrator where we had a team develop the vision for improvement of the district that really filtered down to the building level. So many times in the past, I felt that we would develop a building improvement plan without much direction, a unified direction, not only from the top, but also from the other buildings. And then that seemed to kind of stop there. There didn't seem to be much meat or much substance to it. So this was an effort to develop a plan that was in line with the district improvement plan and also in line with what some of the other buildings were doing. So in similar fashion, I designed mine with the two district theories of action. The first one, as you can see the documents you have with you, first district theory of action, if we have a focused, data-driven, and flexible process to prioritize challenges and opportunities to which we commit time and resources, and which involves appropriate stakeholders in a respective and realistic way, then we will establish a culture of continuous improvement and empower our educators and students to grow and respond in interactive, safe, and accountable ways, and the district will be able to reach its full potential. I think that's a key thing to have as one of our key theories driving not only our goals, but the mission of the high school. There are so many things we're consistently doing that should keep that in mind, continuous improvement. It'd be almost impossible to list every aspect of what we're trying to improve on. Some things that we're trying to improve on might not be in this school improvement plan, but they are continuous. Engagement. We should always be continuing to how do we engage our community, our students, and improve on that? That's never an end result. You always keep on doing that. So this is not only for a goal here, but down the road. We want that to be part of the fabric of the school and how we make decisions. Given that, our first goal that will help with that is to develop a data system to better understand our student population, course offerings, and selection and effective decision making. The demographics information that we have, we're seeing a change in Northampton, our student population. We're also seeing some projections for some differences in the way budget will look. With that, it's going to take a lot of decisions. How are we going to, what are we going to do at the high school with this population? So we need to become more fluent, more skilled at looking at data. What is the data? As you've heard from Principal Wilson, there's much more data beyond MCAS. There's much more data than improving MCAS by 2% and 3%. There is daily, there's attendance, there's visits to the nurse's office, there's discipline. There's data that happens every day. You do a 15-minute lesson, you do an informal assessment. There's all these forms of data that we need to get better at to make the decisions of courses we're going to offer, opportunities for our students, and the way we're going to use our resources to benefit all the students of Northampton High School. So that is the first goal that we have, and you can read there's initiatives underneath that we feel will help with that goal. The second theory of action If we provide systemic collaborative structures and support systems that allow educators to meet new demands and expectations, they will improve instruction, develop individual and collective efficacy, and achieve professional satisfaction, which in turn will improve learning for all students. With that, we felt that we needed to ensure that we have a top-to-bottom administrator, teacher, ESP way of approaching what do we do. Are we unified in our approach to planning, to looking at our data? So goal two is to develop a universal mindset, as you've heard from some of the other colleagues, that all students will take advantage of the academic opportunities, differentiated instruction, and Northampton High School's academic and social and civic learning expectations in order to achieve a level of success we want for all students. One of the key aspects of this goal is, and we spent some time at our school council, for years I believe Northampton has had, Northampton High School, and I think all our schools have had a desire to make what we offer accessible for all our students. But what does access mean? Access means maybe showing the door, showing the pathway, showing the way to get there. What we want to do for this goal is help them take advantage. What do they need to walk through? What do they need to be involved in that access? For years, we've had opportunities for students to engage in our sport programs, after-school programs, our AP, our advanced placement classes. We've taken away the requirements. We've taken away the hurdles. But yet, if you ask someone, we're still struggling to get other populations into those classes. So what is it that we need to do? The access isn't working. It's worked for some. I don't want to mislead you. But how can we get more students to take advantage of those opportunities that are not there? And we believe that some of the related initiatives will help with that. A unified mindset for our faculty and administrators, time for faculty for collaborative opportunities, universal professional and student learning SMART goal of academic language, continuous PD on differentiated instruction, continue our work on curriculum writing, improve our use of Aspen and grade and assignment posting. Two big things, as you know, is our Lens 21 program, and as well as implementing the PE requirement, which will have a major impact on how we offer our classes starting the next class of 2020. And that's it. Questions, thoughts?
Questions or comments for Principal Lombardi?
I just want to say I think that you did a great job. I reviewed it, and a lot of your outline was very, very thorough when it was written down, so there was less room for questions. This is the only reason why I really don't have a lot of questions here, because you were thorough. You answered them, like, within it. And thank you very much. You did a really a very good job. And I enjoyed watching the process of the school council the other day and, you know, seeing how it all got together and it seems like you're starting. Have you had a strong school council in the past?
This is my first school council that we've gone through the process of a voting process. So this was a new school council. We've had strong school councils in the past. I think this school council is bringing in some different strengths and views, but in many ways carrying over, I think, a mindset that there's a genuine desire to take a look at how do we engage families and students that might not be part of the process, you know. And I think, you know, one of the things that it's your job, it's my job, and the school council's job is we have to make ensure that we are a voice in the ears for some populations that don't necessarily have a voice all the time. And I think that school council meeting that you were at last night really was presenting that. They wanted to speak up and try to find a way to reach those students to engage and be active in our school process for success. And as you could see last night, we want this to filter down, there was a lot of discussion on data. How can we use data? That the school council wants to be involved in that process. So again, that mindset, that use of this information is splintering out in decision making.
So this is your first year that you're doing this. So as it was stated in the past, don't remember who said that it was last year's committee that was actually, so is that how, I mean, how did this get done so soon in the year? Did you do it? Did you
I brought it forward.
Build off
I took
it?
A lot. Kind of felt that, you know, one of the things you there's a lot of initiatives going around. I think you've asked not only our teachers, I'm sure if you had in East Hampton, if anything, teachers are almost, schools are almost overwhelmed with initiatives, and you can go from one to another and not complete something. So I really wanted to look at quality versus quantity. We started the PE, as you know, we brought that up last year, and simply adding 4 years of requirement to graduate, you just don't snap your fingers and do it. And I have to look at the time to involve people. That's something that's going to take time. Curriculum writing, differentiated instruction, it's a 3-year plan that we're doing. That's going to take time. Lens 21, meeting the NEASC and creating a culture with Lens 21, using our academic and social language, having that become part of the fabric of how we engage, a universal mindset of that. That takes time. So I really wanted to focus on those and be able to say in a year or two's time, look what we've done. And not just say, okay, we have that, but we're also adding one more thing that's come down the track. I think students, parents, and teachers, that becomes burnout. It becomes, you get a weaker product. I think that people really want to, I think these things are really important. They affect our students. They really are engaged in this, impact students in the classroom. And I wanted to make sure we had time. So I did bring those forth. First I brought to my department chairs and we agreed that it'd be appropriate to focus on these main things that are gonna take time and resources to do them right and be thoughtful about that. And I presented that to the school council and they were in agreement as well. The main discussion at the council was really focusing on access versus being involved, taking advantage of, which I really support. I think that is a key. It's amazing how one word can change so much, but access and taking advantage really are two different things. The advantage is being involved with it, benefiting from it, where access is more, they can see it, doesn't mean they're really benefiting from it.
So do you see, we keep talking about the changes in the student population, so are more kids taking advantage of this access or less, or is it just now something you're just dealing with now?
We've always had access, I believe, but I think some of our challenges, if we look at our MCAS scores, you could say that are you seeing improvements across the range for special needs and low income? That doesn't seem to be keeping pace with others. We know that our ELL population is increasing in the district, so that's going to take something. How do we get them to be, those students have access and not only access, but again, take advantage of our academic classes, our AP classes, if they pursue, our honors classes, our theater classes, our music classes, our choral programs, our sport programs, things like that.
And another question that Mr. Cannata brought up was community involvement. I've attended the last couple of years at the open house, and it seems to me like there's a lot of people there and a lot of community involvement. However, at different events that I've attended also, it seems like there's none. There are very, very, very little. Do you have any say on that as far as the community, as far as, you know, any goals that you're thinking of setting or data to follow?
I think part of the discussion that we had last night was, you know, which direction did the school council want to go in? You know, there's the involvement of parents, which I think we do a good job of communicating levels. I think at the high school level, things kind of splinter off a bit for parents. You can be very involved and a lot of things, many kids are involved, and so I think sometimes parents choose to be involved in very specific things. I think the parent night, if they need that information for parent night in the classes, they're going to come. If they need that information for college or financial aid, they're going to come. Then I think it begins to splinter down to my child's sport, theater, you know, club activity. That's when you kind of see it break down.
They don't want us hanging around really much.
Right.
Sometimes that happens, you know. So I think that's part of the dynamic. But at the same time, we also are aware that there's people there that we want to see more of. And that's part of how do we get, you know, and as Mr. Knott was noticing, you know, when you notice certain families that are there all the time and you get a sense of certain families or students who aren't there. So I think that's a challenge for all the buildings. How do we get that?
And then just one last question that I asked other people was technology. How do you feel that your technology in your building is going at this point?
I think that teachers are eating up technology. I think I recently read something. It's, you know, part of the decision that needs to go into technology is, you know, one, are people ready for it? How is it going to benefit students? But can the system handle that technology? And I would say right now for the high school level is we need to make sure as a district, can our infrastructure handle more? I have about 1,000 people in the building every day. Students can bring their devices. We have about 100, you know, Chromebooks, computer labs. We want more of that, don't get me wrong, but that's a lot of stuff. And then we have all the, you know, we're using Aspen, Oasis, we're using a lot of Wi-Fi, school-based internet access stuff. You know, you can have a lot of stuff, but if you can't use it, that's more frustrating. So I think that we love it, kids love it. You go into classrooms, you see a lot of dynamic things happening. You know, it's really neat. Kids love it. It's really beneficial. But if we're not able to access that when it's needed, when a teacher makes a lesson plan or and they need to access it, we have to make sure that the system upholds that ability.
And so the teachers at the level there, no matter their generation, they're all in all of these different programs or whatnot, you're saying they're still doing okay as far as, you know, learning it, being up to par?
I think there's some, like anywhere else, there's some that I can say that my 20s group, they're ahead of the curve.
Yeah.
They've had it. You know, I think people in my generation, I guess I'm in that generation now, it's more utilitarian and there's a learning curve. I think that people are seeing the benefits. I think the Google Chromebook was probably the easiest thing for teachers really to get a sense, wow, how to use it, because it was technology they could have in their classroom as opposed to going to the computer lab. I think that was a great thing when they realized what they could do with the Google Chromebooks.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Yes.
I have a universal professional and student learning SMART goal of academic language. I mean,
yes.
I know what professional and student learning goals are and SMART goals. I don't understand it all put together in this way, though.
That.
What do you mean by that?
The academic language.
Universal professional and student.
So we decided this year to try to help the school move along at once and not have pockets. And one of the things in part of differentiated instruction is the development of, you know, academic language. And so we felt what we wanted, it was the school to develop their student learning goals and professional practice goals for teachers of academic language. So teachers right now are developing the academic language for their courses that they expect students will learn after that experience. That's it. We're gonna gauge. So we expect students at the end of a course are going to come in with some level of a language. And at the end, there's a vocabulary list that we want them to have. And it's not just specifically for the content. It's also what is the academic language that you use throughout high school. I was at a meeting one time with a student, and we were talking about, well, it's gonna be a trial to what you're doing. What do you mean trial? What's going on? And, you know, again, we use so many trial, as it, you know, he took it in a totally different direction. There's so many words that we use on a continuous basis, analyze, synthesize, deduct, that we take for granted that so many students learn. We forget that many students come from a variety of backgrounds. And research will show that students that come from families of, you know, lower income, different family dynamics, the exposure they have to words, what they gain, exponentially is altered. So we want to make sure that we're providing students with the vocabulary that's not going to stymie their education. So if we can share that information in class when a teacher is talking about biology and we're going to synthesize this today, I want you to sit down and analyze that. They know what that word means. Because if they don't, is that impacting what they're learning, what they're trying to do? How many students might not engage in an activity, might not complete an assignment, might answer the wrong question because they don't understand the fundamental vocabulary for that content area.
So all teachers will have the same?
All teachers are working on that. So I might have my world language teachers getting together saying, hey, what are key words that we're using when we're asking students?
But for their evaluation, they have the same goal. Different language, but same goal.
Yep, yep. Right. My math teachers, my English, yep. Everyone is working on that.
Okay.
So that like to eventually have, if you will, would be a Northampton High School vocabulary book almost that we could give people understand. This is what you could expect. These are the words that we'll be using continuously as part of your education. And I'm not talking vocab like, you know.
Hegemony.
Yeah, you know what I'm saying? Yeah, but for example. So that would be the goal, you know, that we'll see the rest of our lives in other areas as well.
Thanks.
Laura, did you have a question?
Yeah, I just wanted to say I'm happy to see the goal one about developing the data system to help understand better the course offering selection, all that. I don't know how to say this without, I'm sure you know, sometimes parents with over 900 students, we hear like, oh, my student wasn't able to get in this class or that class. Having worked through, I was on the physical education implementation committee,
and I was so overwhelmed, and you were so patient walking me through it, but exactly what you say, you think, we'll just add another class, and every time I came up with a suggestion, you'd be like, well, if I add this, where are we going to meet? Who's going to be the teacher? What's going to happen? What are they going to take instead? It is such an absolutely complicated puzzle that you've got to try and fit together so that every student gets every course that they would like offered at the right time, and each teacher has exactly the number of courses to teach that they need. And I wish that parents appreciated more how difficult that whole process is, because I know I didn't. And so I hope that developing this data system makes your job a little bit easier, because I was so frustrated and overwhelmed trying to figure out how to make it all work. And I was really impressed by what you guys do over there.
Thank you. Appreciate that. You know, my new plan is have meetings in my office. I have a new board with my schedule on magnets, and it's all color-coded. And I think people see it, and they're like, it's a combination of Tetris and Rubik's Cube all at once. And I think, like, that's it. You know, there's thousands of math computations in this. So it's not, we want to meet every student's needs, and we hope that by having some data will improve our decision-making and what we offer. I mean, our bottom line, again, is to support every student, and every student, again, not only access, but to take advantage of what we have. I think we're good at what we do, and that's kind of a problem, is that people aren't trying to avoid things, they're trying to take things. And they're at the restaurant, they want to surf and turf. You know, sometimes it's hard.
Is the PTO very active?
Yes, PTO is fantastic.
Is it going this way, upward as far as from last year? Has it always been the same?
PTO has been, they're phenomenal. They if you remember, 2 years ago, they had a program to raise $19,000. They're continuously, you know, what do you need, from simple things of teacher appreciation, luncheons and breakfasts, which, you know, every building we benefit from, but, you know, they are very active in small grants for teachers. I recently sat down with Monica Green and Wendy Bernstein about how they were going to divvy up about $4,800 and grants for teachers. So they're fantastic. I can't say enough about them. We really benefit from very strong from the NEF. We had a representative from the NEF come to school council last night to PTO. Northampton High School, and I know the other schools, really benefit from a very active and supportive community that values education.
You have the school improvement plan. How busy are students, the student government? I mean, do you have a strong sense of student government there?
I would say that's an area that we need to work on. We have active school officers in terms of class presidents in that aspect, and really focusing on, you know, activities for each class along that. I would say, you know, that down the road, that would be an area for us to take a look at and have a more viable school council to that. That would be great.
Last week when I was at the Hyannis on Saturday, they had the high school students gave a forum themselves, and that was one of the things that they said that they had wanted, just a general consensus of kids from the different areas, that they had wanted to feel more involved in the actual processes and being asked as far as the school improvement plan and everything. And I was, you know, I mean, you had four students there last night. It was very nicely represented and everything.
Yep.
I was just wondering how the government part of it is. You know, they have a strong student council and all of that.
That would definitely be an area for us to look at and improve upon, without a doubt. But you're right. The students we had last night, the school council, were very involved. You know, one of the students sent me an email this morning wondering if the NEF SOS fund, you know, how is it that we order books, and if we're not looking at Amazon, how do we guarantee that we're getting the best value for our books and our expenditure? And I wanted to give him Candy's number, because I think he's looking. but it was great. You know, here's a student really questioning, you know, how do we access, you know, that funds, and are we using our money wisely? And to have a student at that level, freshman, bring that up, I think that says a lot about their, you know, where they're at and wanting to be involved in decisions at the high school.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Thank you, Mr. Meyer.
I just wonder if you could quantify the population that you're concerned about, and on a certain extent, the degree, because, I mean, looking at your school, it's very successful. You're sending, 80% plus students on to higher education. Mm-hmm. So clearly, a lot of kids are taking advantage. So I'm wondering, what's the size of the population that is not taking full advantage or as much advantage as you would like and as the people in your, on your staff would like? And also, is there a degree, how far, sort of, what is the degree to which you want to push them ahead? What is the, again, Northampton High School is a place with a lot of diversity in terms of where kids can go, and that's a strength. Mm-hmm. But what are you trying to, for a kid walking through the door coming from JFK or from some other middle school experience, what do you want that kid to think about as this is, again, a unified mindset? Mm-hmm. Should they all be saying, I really want 4 years of post-secondary school, because that's an, you know, that's what people in this building expect. If life takes me in a different direction, that's fine, but at least that's the expectation coming in. I'm just wondering, again, sure, size of the population that we're talking about, yep, here, and also the degree to which you're trying to adjust those expectations. Yeah.
So I think the size, we're trying to figure that out. I think that we have a lot of assumptions what that size is. I know that we spend a lot of time administratively and teachers worrying about students that aren't doing well. I know that population, then we have conversations with Lori Farkas and special ed and 504, and we're trying to figure out, okay, what is this population? How big is it? And then what do we do to find interventions? You could argue that it could be that 15 or 20% that isn't going on to school. Well, where are they going on to? And are they not going to school because they couldn't go there, or they wanted something else? Did we help them find that something else? Okay, so we want to find out, let's look at, you know, who are students in terms of who is passing classes, D and F list, for example, who is moving along. You know, every student should be passing 8 classes a school year, you know. So what's happening with those rates? We want to take a look at what students are taking which classes. And then that's going to help us determine what interventions do we do. What do we do with those? And then it's conversations with each student. Okay, that student might be struggling. Why are you struggling? Is it because they're not, you know, they could have grit. I think any kid that comes to school, continues to come to school, they want something. Okay, they're showing some grit. Our job should be, well, what if you're struggling and you're still coming, what is that you want? Is it 4-year school? Great. Is it 2-year school? Great. Is it I'm interested in the military? I want a career. I want to work. There was a student that, I got to tell Leslie the student's name when I'm done, because I think she'll be wowed. I was at the gym recently talking to a friend who's neighbors of this kid who recently bought, he graduated 2 years ago, he's 19 years old, and he recently bought a house in cash. He's turning it over. And I was like, wow. And Leslie will be wow when I talk about this after. He struggled in school. He struggled academically at Northampton. He went to Smith Volk, struggled, came back to us, and struggled here. We got him through just being creative, patching things together. He was a kid that I knew growing up. He was friends with my son for years. And he was that kid on a snow day that when everyone else was in the house sleeping late or playing Nintendo, he was out there earning money shoveling snow. But yet he struggled school. He gets out of school. He finds out his interest is he wants to make money. He starts buying cars and reselling the parts of cars, and finds out there's this whole economy, this whole niche out there of the wheeling and dealing of cars and car parts, going to dealerships, and you know, they try to get cars off the lot at a certain time of the year because they got to get new cars in. And he's just massaging that and working in it, cash deal, bought this house, cash, and he's flipping it over, and he's excited. And to me, that's a kid that did he fail school, or did school fail him by not tapping into the interests he had? So I think our thing is to identify students like that are struggling. And instead of trying to say, you know, you need to go down this route, you need to go down this track, how can you build in things that he was interested in and make him feel successful?
He's 19, right?
19 right now.
Yeah. That was what I found amazing.
19. So I'm not sure if that answers your question. The data really is going to give us a sense of how big this population is. That 20% is really, I think that's the part that we're trying to get more clarity to. So the 20 that they're not going to school, well, where are they going? But also, more importantly, why are they there? Are there parts of that 20% that could be over here if they wanted to, by us doing things differently in terms of offering classes or courses for them at the high school? Then let's get that population there. Over the last few years, we've shifted some of our classes. We've added some support classes. As you'd mentioned, tier 2. at a high school level, it's really hard to offer a tier two pull-out intervention for math or in English, but I might need to offer a support math, a pre-integrated one math type of thing, a pre-English, freshman English. So we've taken a look at adding that, so that's some data. In that 20%, okay, you don't want to be in there, we've identified that, but are you being supported in a way that the next step after graduation is logical and supportive for you, from, you know, internship, work studies, even course selections that we have? Okay.
Other questions for Principal Lombardi? Thank you very much. We appreciate
Thank
it.
Thank you.
Oh, sorry, Ms. Minnick.
First of all, I wanted to thank all of the principals that came this evening and presented. They were excellent presentations. It was very interesting for us to hear them. But I just want to note the absolute consistency in their comments that say to me that work done during an entry plan and then root cause analysis and all of the work that our superintendent has done has absolutely paid off in the kind of unity of thinking and the process of developing all of the individual school improvement plans. Everyone said this is the first time they felt like it was easy for them to make their school improvement plan align with the district improvement plan. We've been doing this for I don't even know how many years. So thank you for your work, but it's really cool to see you. I don't know if you can say you're excited about a school improvement plan. It's like, oh God, here we go again. But just the same, it does come across as enthusiasm for doing something that you're required to do. And I think it's all attributable to our new superintendent. So my thanks to you as well.
And to all.
Excellent. So that completes the student improvement plan. So we have a couple of votes on some gifts. The first is a vote. This is Vin's $1,625 for Raptor School Visitor Management Software for Ryan Road. I know Principal Madden's here. If you wanted to just speak to that quickly.
Yes.
So the VINS coordinator, Marlene Pearson, brought this up to everybody at ALT at one point. And she's housed in our building, so I see her more frequently. That's a lucky relationship. And she brought up the idea of doing a trial. And would we be interested in doing a trial on this automated check-in? And when I heard more about it, and our PTO heard more about it, and our school council heard more about it, we agreed that we would participate in the trial. And it's not going to cost us. They got an anonymous donation, I guess Vins did, so that we could do this. And I think for me, I know Vins wants to keep better track of their volunteers, but I also think that we don't really have a way to capture information about who's in our schools. You know, people very messily write in there that they're visiting, but I can't tell. And if I'm trying to figure out if a parent had visited that day, I can't read it. I can't. The signatures are really messy. There's really no way to use that kind of information. I'm not exactly sure who's in the building if we ever did have an emergency. It's a little hard to tell from the messy writing that people do. And I also think over time it might be interesting to have an electronic record of who's coming and when. But I also, maybe this is because of my age and my memory, but I'm also really excited about the idea that they just come in and wave their ID, and the printout will come with their picture and their name. And we have a lot of volunteers in our building, and I always feel guilty because I cannot remember the names of all of them, but there's going to be why you're there, what your name is, you know, and when you came. So I think that would also be very helpful. And it also gives an immediate alert for national sex offenders, if that was something we had to worry about. So those are the things that I sort of see as advantages, but I don't know how we're going to feel about it. It's a trial.
Okay. So there'll be some kind of a monitor display in the office?
Yes.
Where people would typically sign a form, there'll be a display. And,
mm-hmm.
yeah.
And once you log in, mm-hmm. then you don't ever have to log in again. You can, you know, you just swipe. So we'll see.
Okay. Excellent. So any other questions about this? Ms. Hannah?
I hope I can answer them.
So after the 30-day trial, if you decide that this is something that, you know, a system that we want to keep, do we know what the costs are?
So Vins is committed to extending the trial for this year. And then we'll see.
Ms. Hennessy.
Is there privacy with, like, let's say, like, sex offender, I mean, like.
That, it would just be an alert that I would get.
Okay, you would just get that. Okay.
Yes.
We
know that goes on their chest.
Like arms.
Okay. I was joking with her. She was laughing at me. I'm sorry if we were disruptive, but I was just saying Raptor sounds like such a welcoming kind of.
I thought the same thing. It's a very odd. Yeah.
Is there any pitfall that you see as a potential problem?
That's right.
Well, I think with any new system, it's going to be an adjustment to get used to it. And I'm hoping it's not a big pain at first, you know, for people in the office. We'll see. We'll see how it goes.
I can say that the senior center a couple of years ago implemented an electronic check-in system. Mm-hmm. People have cards that they swipe and to sign in for activities, and there's two monitors. And, you know, it seems like it works well. And
that's good to know.
It's a better way for them to catalog who's in the senior center, as well as keep track of who's subscribing to what programs and what activities and what times of day. So
interesting.
There you go. So. Seniors can do it, I suspect elementary school parents can do it.
I'm getting right up there, so everybody have a name on their shirt.
So do we have a motion to accept this?
Motion to accept the what are we doing for the
Raptor
visitor management software kit?
Is there a second? Not a Raptor sound, but a second.
I don't even know what sound a Raptor makes.
Okay.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. It's very exciting.
The next is a gift from the Jackson Street PTO. This is $250, and it's for artist in residence B.Z. Riley. Ms. Walsing.
Yes, Jackson Street had an NEF grant that paid for visiting artists, and the teachers were interested in extending it for a few more visits, so the PTO agreed to supplement the grant monies with a donation to the school to cover some additional hours for the visiting artist.
To accept Jackson Street PTO gift.
Second.
Any questions or discussion about this? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, the gift is gratefully accepted. Next, there's a gift. This is for Ronald McDonald House Charities. And it's a $1,000 gift to Northampton High School. And again, I'll turn to you, Ms. Walczak.
Yep. The Ronald McDonald Charities of Connecticut and Western Mass selected 10 teachers from the area of all of Connecticut and Western Mass to receive this Local Hero Awards. And one of the teachers that was selected was from Northampton High School, Kate Dollard. So they're making a $1,000 donation to the high school in recognition of her work as a teacher. And the monies will actually be used for science supplies within her department. Okay.
Move to approve.
Second. Accept. Yep.
Okay. Move to accept.
So there's been a motion made and seconded. Any discussion or questions about this? All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that gift is accepted. I believe the next item on the agenda, we're gonna flip things around a little bit, and we're gonna move to the presentation of the 2015 MCAS results from Dr. Provo. What's that?
You gonna move?
I have a minute. There's a presentation.
Sure. So we're gonna we need to just set up the technology. So we'll just be a few minutes to do that.
Can we actually have a break?
Like, why don't we do a what do you think? Okay. I think we need a 5-minute recess. So let's do a 5-minute recess, please, just so we can get everything set up. So we're returning to the November 12, 2015 school committee meeting, and we'll now turn the floor over to Superintendent Provost, who will be presenting MCAS results.
Thank you very much. This is a presentation that was held over from last month's school committee meeting, if you'll recall. I think that in the intervening weeks, there's been a lot of anticipation because this was on the agenda, but then was not able to be delivered. And so people were wondering what I was going to say. Was it going to be good news? Was it going to be bad news? So I just want to start by saying I think the story told by the 2015 MCAS results overall is very positive. And I think that everyone within the sound of my voice should feel good about changes that we see in terms of student achievement at the aggregate level. But I'm concerned about, you know, not just overall growth, but helping us to develop true excellence in the district, which means that I also have to point out to you if there are any things within the overall positive news that we could do better with. So let me start with sort of the most, the grossest view of it. And this is sort of a survey of trends, as the title says. I think it's important not to pay attention to every little wiggle in the data, but to see what does the big picture say. So, whoops, that was not the right button to push. Does anyone know? I'm going to try not to push that button again. There we go. So first I want to talk about overall progress made in English language arts. This is 2015 results showing all grades for English language arts. And I'm happy to report that it's a good improvement over the prior year. We have more students in proficient and advanced and fewer students in needs improvement and warning. We've been sort of stuck for a few years at 30% in needs improvement and warning, and last year we were able to reduce that to 28%. At the same time, having 24% of our students in the advanced category, which is the highest number we've had in the last 4 years shown in this trend. So I think overall we've made good progress in English language arts. Similarly, we've made overall good progress in mathematics. You can see again, there's a reduction in the number of, or the percentage of students who are in the warning and needs improvement categories, and an increase in the number of students who are proficient and advanced, and an increase in the students in the very top category of advanced. Similarly, we've made overall progress in science. Again, the overall numbers of students in the warning and needs improvement category is lower than it's been recently, and the numbers of students proficient and advanced has increased. In this case, the number of students in the advanced category dropped slightly from 22% to 21%, but that was offset by a very large reduction in the number of students who were in the needs improvement and warning category. So I think all that is good, and I think, again, that the students and their parents and their teachers and the administrators and the school committee are all to be congratulated for that. But, you know, I'd like to look at this in a little bit more detail. We take a lot of time and effort in this state to assess students, so I think it's worthy of not just doing sort of a box score analysis, but looking within the results to see if there are any hints for how we could do better. Some methods that I think are important when looking at MCAS scores more critically are populations to means. I think that's important because there are large trends that are affecting the whole state that every district gets sort of sucked along with. And so you want to try to determine whether or not what you're seeing in your individual district is just a reflection of the larger statewide trends, or whether it's something that's unique to your district. So if you're comparing your results to the statewide average or population mean, then you have a way of sort of teasing that out. I think it's also important to look at cohort groups. That last set of data that I gave you looked at all of the students in grades 3 through 10. But you know, students are individuals, classes have their own personalities, and anyone who's been in a classroom knows that things can change year to year based on the individuals you have in front of you. There are certain classes that have certain personalities that I think are more disposed to success, and other students that have personalities that make teaching and learning more challenging. So when you're looking at cohort groups moving along, you're trying to compare, you're trying to control for the individual differences of the students rather than what may be based on the difference from grade to grade as new classes come in. And then the third thing, which I don't talk a lot about in this presentation, but we'll talk about at one point, is looking at growth scores. And that is related to the last point, because even though students may come into a grade with a lower level of preparation, they can still grow. And so for me, I think looking at growth scores can be more informative than looking at achievement scores, because, you know, really the question is whether students are getting better, whether they're getting closer to mastering the goals and objectives that have been outlined in the curriculum. Our growth scores in Massachusetts have kind of a very rough measure. There's an on-target range from 41% to 59%, and then basically the only way to discriminate between that on target range is anyone 40 and below is below target, anyone 60 and above is above target. So you can see it's not a very fine-grained analysis. It's very difficult to measure growth in any kind of a consistent way, but I think it is important to take a look at whether particular grade levels or particular cohorts are progressing at target, above target, or below target, because it gives us a sense of whether or not we're helping the students get what they need in order to master the content that's being put before them. So just to illustrate one of those concepts, change relative to state average matters. This is a graph that looks at the variance of the fourth grade population mean in ELA and math, and this the blue line is ELA, the red line is math. This is looking at the years 2011 to 2014, and these are the statewide averages. So the state goes to a lot of effort and assures us that each year's MCAS is equivalent to all the prior year's MCASs. And I'm not saying that that's not true, but you'll see that the statewide averages fluctuate quite a bit. This is just an example, what happens at fourth grade. The same thing happens at every other grade. So if you're just taking a look at this example, a district that showed improvement in ELA and math from 2011 to 2012 ought to really take a look at the changes that were taking place in the statewide scores before congratulating itself, because it may have just sort of been carried along by whatever it was about the fourth grade test that year that showed everybody, allowed everyone to improve. Likewise, a district that showed a decline in scores between 2012 and 2013, well, at least in ELA, may not necessarily see that as a cause for alarm if it was consistent with the overall changes that took place in the ELA test that year. For reasons that we can't explain, we know that every year's test doesn't perform exactly the same. So I think it's important to take a look at ourselves in comparison to what happened at the state level, rather than just in comparison to ourselves in a prior year, which after all was a different test. So here I'm looking at the ELA cohorts. So this is showing students the last six grades of students who were taking ELA tests in the elementary and middle school. So you can see the eighth grade has the longest line because that's the only group that had the opportunity to take the test in third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, and eighth grade. And then subsequent cohorts have shorter lines because they haven't gotten all the way to the end of that eighth grade trajectory. So a couple of things that I'd point out with respect to our ELA scores. One is that over the past 3 years, there's been a trend towards higher and higher achievement at the end of the fifth grade level. So you can see, if you look at that box with the circle on top and the arrow coming out, this yellow line, which is this year's sixth graders, last year's fifth graders, it has been higher than the two prior groups. The only group that was higher was the eighth graders, or current ninth graders, when they were in fifth grade. So I think that's a positive trend, and I think that's something that points to good work being done with English language arts at the later elementary grades. The next piece, though, and I would like to point out, and you know, people have asked, because people know that I'm a little bit concerned with early literacy, says that the opposite trend has been happening in third grade. So if you look, those last 3 years have been going down and down and down in terms of achievement levels at the third grade, which is the first measure we get. You know, you all received the memo that I sent out after the Gazette reported on our test scores, and I used the scoring drive analogy. When I look at this, what it seems to me is we're sort of losing the battlefield, the field position battle here. Each year, we're receiving the ball deeper and deeper in our territory, and we've got much farther to carry it forward. So that's concerning me a little bit. Last year's third grade achievement was about 10% below the statewide average. And yes?
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
John, have you noticed do you have data on the number of students whose parents opted them out of the test? And was that increasing at the third grade level?
I have some information about that. My sense is that it wasn't enough to skew this.
Okay.
Thank you. Good question. So that's one piece of concern I have. The other piece of concern I have is if you sort of look at where scores are coming at the end of fifth grade, you notice they're about where they were in third grade. You know, for the seventh and sixth graders, they kind of bounced down in fourth grade and then came back up to where they were in fifth grade. For our current sixth graders, they bounced up in fourth grade and then landed back down where they were in fifth grade. So, you know, right now, if I'm looking to predict where kids are going to be at the end of fifth grade, I think that third grade score is probably one of the best predictors that we have. So, you know, it concerns me not just now, but for the future.
I have a question.
Yes.
Is this the year that they're in now, so the eighth grade is the current eighth grade, or
it's the year they were in last year.
Okay.
But I want to say that, you know, my concern is not just about the scores. In fact, that's probably the least of my concerns. This leads into a much bigger discussion that I think we need to consider in terms of early literacy. This graph is similar to one that the Early Childhood Associates does. This is a group that does a lot of the work with early childhood education. Barbara Black and I attended several of their conferences last year. Barbara attended, I think, probably all of them. I only got to two, I think. But they were also presenting at the MASS-MASC conference last week. And one of the things they say is, if you want to have a good measure of how things are going in the early grades, take a look at your third grade reading proficiency. And they have a map like this that shows the whole state. This is a map that just shows our county. It's slightly different. the intervals here are every 10 points. They use intervals that are like 14 points. But you see where Northampton stands with respect to some of its peers and surrounding communities. So we're in the 50 to 59% proficient band. And so the question is that the right band, you know? There are places where a superintendent could show a map like this and that would be the end of the discussion. It does lend itself to sort of a box score kind of thinking that I'm not trying to encourage. You know, one of the things that I would guard against is wanting to have scores like neighboring communities just because we want to be as good or better than other communities. You know, that's a kind of disordered thinking in my perspective. It's a kind of covetousness for scores, if you will, and it can lead you to bad places. You know, one of the things that I found personally a little bit distracting at that event was tournaments were going on, you know, and there were many school committee members who were very concerned about not only the results of each of the games that their local districts were involved with, but every play of every game that was happening during the week we were there. So I'm not wanting us just to compete for scores, but I'm wanting to put that out there because it says something. One of the things people have asked is, well, can you present this data in the context of socioeconomic status? And I definitely want to do that because this is such an interesting graph. I've done this many times with many MCASs through the years. This shows the distribution of students who are proficient and advanced in third grade reading on the y-axis. On the x-axis, it shows the percent of students in the district who are identified as economically disadvantaged. So you see that SES has a very powerful influence on student achievement. And it's amazing that it lines up almost on a perfect line. You almost don't need the computer to draw the regression line for you. You could just drop a ruler down and come up with the same thing. But what I believe is fair is you can ask yourself, well, are we making the line? You know, are we doing as well as we could expect to do based on the socioeconomic status of our students? And that little yellow triangle right there is our third grade students. So, you know, based on the context of students' SES, I think we're not doing as well as we could do with the third grade students. And that's why I say it's not right or appropriate or good or healthy to just want to have the highest scores around. If we go back to the prior map, I don't think we should be one of the communities that's in the red because they're very different than us in terms of their SES. But we should be one of the communities that's in the green. You know, we should be able to have about 10% more of our third graders proficient in reading.
This chart here, is that the state? Is that just the local area? What is this?
That's the whole state. And the reason why it doesn't have more dots is, as you know, about half of the districts in the state did PARC. So this only includes the districts that did MCAS. But there's a more important reason even than this for me to be thinking about early, and for us all to be thinking about early literacy. And that's because a lot of students who struggle with early literacy end up getting identified as students with disabilities. And it usually happens around the third grade level. This graph just shows the number of students we have in Northampton who are identified as students with disabilities. You can see K1 and 2 are all consistent about 30 to 35 students, but then it takes a tremendous jump in grade 3, about 50% more, and then by the end of fifth grade, it's almost 100% more. Because nothing catches the attention of a teacher and a parent than a third grader who's not reading as he or she should. And that's what I'm really concerned about. I want us to have a system that doesn't put kids into categorical programs because we're not reaching them as well as we could. I want us to have a system that is flexible enough to serve students well enough that you don't see this tremendous jump from K1 and 2 to 3, 4, 5, you know? Those kids identified in K1 and 2 are kids we know have disabilities. Many of them are medically related disabilities. Many of them are disabilities that they'll struggle with their whole lives. But many of the kids in 3, 4, and 5 are kids that we're placing into special education because we weren't able to reach them as well as we should have in terms of their academic growth. So, you know, disability is in part a socially constructed concept. And this shows it in one way. This next chart shows it in another way. This is looking at our current enrollment, students for special education, and you can see about two-thirds of them are boys. You know, there are certain disabilities that do kind of attach to the Y chromosome, but for if we're making these calls accurately, it should be more like a 50-50 split. So what's happening, and this is really why I'm concerned with early literacy, is there are a lot of boys who aren't learning how to read as well as they could, and then we're saying they have disabilities. That concerns me as a father of a boy. You know, there's a lot of pain that goes along with being identified as a kid with a disability. A lot of pain for parents whose kids are identified as having disabilities. And I want us to stop causing that to the extent that we can. Sure.
How do we know it's over-identification versus under-identification?
Well, that is
all these previous slides, you know?
Yeah, so that's a great question. I mean, some people flip it on the other end and say, you know, one of the reasons why we identify more boys than girls is because boys have more obnoxious ways of letting you know when they're not learning, and girls can quietly fail, and so they can slip through the sort of nets. But, you know, I guess my contention would be that one of the things you find is that when you break it down, as this slide does, it turns out that it's not just boys, but it's particular types of boys, you know? So I think you're picking up other things and calling it disability, you know? One of the things that we're also picking up is ELLs, you know? Right now, you know, I've talked about our overall special education identification rate being much too high in the aggregate, but it's super high in certain subgroups. If you're an ELL, the rate is almost 45%. So to me, it says, are we doing a good job of distinguishing between disability and difference? And do we have a humane enough concept of the differences that students bring to us? And you know, I would ask the question, whichever way it goes in terms of our gender mismatch, are we humane enough to understand the differences that boys bring to the table and the differences that girls bring to the table so that we don't have this split in how we're identifying them? So ELA highlights. Positive trends. Fourth grade performance has increased dramatically, fifth grade as well. Fifth grade scores are at the statewide average for the first time since 2008. And if you look at cohorts, you'll see that they progress relative to the statewide average from fourth to eighth grade as they go through the middle school. So concerning trends, I've talked about, you know, it's really that grade three, the early literacy. Lowest percentage of third grade students proficient or advanced since 2001. And, you know, I said this last week, it's true. I don't want this to be the soundbite. I want the other things to be the soundbite. But this is the first time since 2007 that third grade results at all four elementary schools are below the statewide average. So that's why I think overall the ELA program is strong and making good progress, but we have to put some attention at the early level. So moving on to math, this is a different story. Here you see the shorter lines, which are the newer cohorts, the younger kids, for the last 3 years have all been better than the ones in the prior years. So I think that math instruction in general is getting better. And again, you have the fifth grade group here that's much higher than other fifth grades have been. This is something I hear a lot when I talk to Ms. Wilson. They're very excited about the skills of the new sixth graders, both in ELA and math. This looks like a very strong group of students, and I do think that's a credit to the work that's being done in the elementary schools. The concern that I think we have with math is what happens from fifth to sixth grade. So you see the last two groups or three groups that have gone through have shown a pretty significant decline, about a 10% decline as they go from fifth to sixth grade. It bounces right back in seventh grade. So, you know, this is kind of like the ELA story, only at a different grade level. Here the issue isn't, okay, how do we have a third grade that is as strong as the other grades? It's how do we have a sixth grade that's as strong as the other grades? You know, if you could just sort of imagine bending the curve between fifth to sixth grade, when that seventh grade boost kicked in, you'd see that, you know, you'd expect the class to be in a real, really strong position going into eighth grade and then going into the high school. So let me just catch up. So positive trends in math. Elementary scores are improving. There's this great increase in achievement between sixth and seventh grade that seems to be stable. It seems to be something that we're able to reproduce every year. It's, I think, a credit to what's happening at the middle school in math. But, you know, well, I'll get to the but later. So there's a general improvement of scores as students go from fourth to eighth grade, just as there was for ELA. So the trend, the concern really is that dip from fifth to sixth grade and sort of the overall achievement. All but two of the points on that graph are below statewide averages. And this is where growth comes in. The one time I'll talk about growth. The last year's sixth grade group was the only group, and all of those data points where the growth was actually in that 0 to 40% level. So it shows that, you know, the growth was also not there from fifth to sixth grade as we would like to see. So we're going to talk about plans for both the third grade ELA and sixth grade math in a minute, but I just want to take a minute to talk about the high school. You have to do, I believe, a different kind of analysis for the high school because you can't follow the cohort through all the way. It's interrupted because there's no testing in ninth grade. And there's a lot of turnover, as I mentioned in the entry findings. The kids in 10th grade are not necessarily the same grades as the same kids who were in grade 8 2 years before. And the statewide averages are very different in 10th grade than they are for any other grade. That's for two reasons, I think. It's the only test with high stakes attached to it, which means it's the only test where students have a very powerful external motivation to do well on that. And also the state has a very powerful external motivation to make sure that the cut scores are set at a point where a lot of people pass. So I think here you have to look at, well, are we closing gaps? I think that's the most important thing you can look at the high school. So these, I think, are really, really interesting and good graphs. So, you know, last year there was a large emphasis on differentiating instruction. You see in ELA, there was a lot of closing that went on between 14 and 15. In this graph, the blue are the non-high need students and the red are the high need students. One of the we weren't in the business of giving theories of action at the time, but I think sort of the implicit theory of action was, if we can differentiate instruction better, then we'll close gaps between the non-high need students and the high need students. And I think in ELA we did that last year. And you know, that non-high needs group stayed pinned almost to 100% proficient and advanced, but the non-high need groups came up. So I think it's also good, because some people were concerned, would this hurt the non-high need students? Would it hurt the kids who were already doing well? I think the experience at the high school in ELA was that it did not. Math gap closing, again, you can see strong improvements last year with the high needs subgroup. And again, the non-high needs group stayed basically where they were. This whole set is a little bit lower than ELA because, you know, there's a little bit more room for growth in math than there is in ELA. But again, it's the same pattern. The non-high needs kids did as well as they were doing before, but the high needs kids improved significantly. And then science, same thing. So I think the high school did really good work with differentiation last year. We heard the high school improvement plan. We heard, I think, the principal's emphasis on trying to make sure that every kid was reached in some way, making sure that more kids got the opportunity, and not just the opportunity, but the encouragement to push themselves and take advantage of the challenges available at the high school. And I think that's in part to the explanation for the gap closing we saw at the high school. So just in summary, we increased proficient and advanced and reduced warning in all tested subjects. We were very effective at closing gaps between high needs and non-high needs students at the high school level. Our areas of concern and areas where I think we should focus our attention for trying to move, you know, from high performing system to higher performing system is early literacy, sixth grade math, and the over-identification of students with disabilities, especially male students in ELLs. So some thoughts on how we're going to do that. You've heard a lot about response to intervention, and of course that's one of the answers to a lot of these things. And we've talked a lot in the earlier school improvement plan presentations about the interventions that are taking place in ELA and math. One of the things that we haven't talked about as much are the social emotional components of that. And this has been an area that I've wanted to focus on for a long time. This has been an area that I addressed in my first letter to staff. It's an area that I addressed in my evaluation subcommittee last year, saying I want to get on top of social emotional learning. So one of the things that we did this year was the strengths and difficulties questionnaire. First time we did a universal screening for students who are struggling with emotional difficulties, conduct issues, peer problems, or hyperactivity. And so we found that we've got about 13% to 19% of our elementary kids who are having problems with one of these areas based on that screening. And we're in the process right now of setting up interventions to help those kids, because what I think anyone who's been around young kids will tell you is, if the emotional difficulties are in place, if the child doesn't understand how to follow the rules that allow learning to take place, if the student can't connect with peers or is in conflict with peers or is unable to focus, then that can become an absolute block to learning. It can put everything else off the table. And it's 13 to 19% of our young learners. So I think if we can get a handle on providing these kids with the specific help that they need to overcome these four areas of concern, they'll learn better, but more importantly, they'll be happier. So, you know, our intervention triangle has three components. One is reading, one is math, one is social emotional. I'm really happy that we're bringing all three to the table, because I think when you combine those, it's going to be a really powerful way of addressing some of the concerns that I pointed out. The initial adaptations have to be curricular. You know, we're working on curriculum. Secondary strategy at the elementary levels is the implementation of RTI, including in the social, emotional, what some people call the affective domains. So let me just give you a sense of what that looks like. This is a chart of our RTI cycles. So we think we have enough time in the year to do two intervention cycles. We did a fall screening. The academic screenings were completed much more quickly than the social emotional screening, so we're now in the first round of interventions. One of the things we heard was that we didn't have enough intervention personnel to provide all of the interventions that kids could have benefited from based on their screening results in the first round. So the winter screening may end up getting tweaked. It may end up being a little bit simpler. It might be basically all the kids we couldn't get in the fall, maybe we can get them in the spring. But we're going to have two cycles of intervention for reading and for math. And the reading intervention is the leveled literacy intervention. The math intervention we're doing is the math recovery intervention. The social emotional interventions we're doing, we're in the process of kind of working those out right now. So we may only get one social emotional intervention cycle in this first year, but we'll get better. And that's all stuff we didn't have last year. And I really think this is going to help kids. And I think this is going to help us stop identifying kids as having disabilities if it's something else. Because we'll know from these interventions whether the kid just needed a different way in order to learn, or whether there is a disability that's blocking learning. So I'm very hopeful for this. We also have some plans and some changes for sixth grade, and I actually have a sixth grade math teacher here with me tonight, so I'd like to invite Phil Cody up here just to talk about some of the things that sixth grade teachers are planning to do to try to address that sixth grade math issue.
Where should I begin?
How about July?
July, okay. Well, I guess what this comes down to is just in the last month, I kind of changed the pedagogical environment of my classroom and what I was doing. I got frustrated not being able to meet the needs of all my students, either teaching to the center or trying to differentiate from the center. And I realized that the only way I was going to meet those needs was to really meet with each student. And so I kind of threw everything out the window and started from scratch. And am now, instead of chalk and talk or walking around the classroom, I'm meeting in small groups. My kids are given a menu of assignments. When they're given a lesson, there's work that they can do, work that they can do between lessons, challenges that I can assign them. I modify the work for each student on a day-to-day basis. I keep track of the various, what I talk about at each meeting with each student, whether that's division of fractions, multiplication of decimals. I have the date that I did that I met with each student or each small group of students. And I'm finding that the kids are happier, more engaged. I'm happier. I'm able to get to know my students better. There's fewer kids that are flying under my radar because they're quiet or reserved. And overall behavior is better. How it shakes out in the end, I'm not sure. It's kind of in a beta version right now. But this, I guess, is falling back on my experience as a Montessori teacher. And I knew that that was the way, what I needed to do in the classroom. And I'm, you know, now pursuing that. So really that's what that's about. And I thank Principal Wilson really for giving me the freedom to experiment in the classroom like this. But I think it's working out really well. And I'm welcome to field any questions.
Sir, I would just want to throw a couple of other things in that I know you're working on. I put a a picture of the sixth grade curriculum revision. This is kind of an ambitious revision. But one of the things that the team found is that many of the concept, let me say this. This is why it's great to have curriculum, you know? Remember last year I was talking about how critically important it was to get curriculum into some kind of a system so we knew what we were teaching. Well, last year, one of the findings was that many of the key concepts that teachers were teaching in sixth grade were actually taught after the testing period. And so one of the thoughts was, well, if we can accelerate the curriculum, then we may have an opportunity to expose kids to some of the concepts prior to being tested, and that is likely to have an impact on, you know, their ability to demonstrate mastery. Now, I'll say this was probably way too ambitious. I think the teachers would agree that it's hard to keep up with this and they're kind of slipping behind, but it's a curriculum intervention that we can make now that we couldn't even make before because we were too disorganized on what the curriculum was. The other thing similar to the high school is I know a lot of the intervention in sixth grade has been around math vocabulary and just making sure that kids understand some of the basic vocabulary concepts that they're going to face as they address these things. So I just want to throw those in. Okay. So that's, do you want to say something else?
No, I guess if there are any questions for what's going on in sixth grade, with my colleagues Michelle Eastman and Diana Smith, we've been working hard at trying to figure out how exactly we can increase student growth for the sixth grade. And you know, we've been, you know, what I'm doing in my classroom now, I think, is that. Yes, Blue.
I think it's pretty incredible that you're taking that amount of time to be able to isolate and analyze from each child. Is that taking an awful lot of time from your day, and how is that affecting your teaching and the actual curriculum?
No, I think it seems more efficient to me. I feel like I have my pulse on what's going on in the room, in the classroom, in a much more realistic manner. And like I said, there's not just some kids getting the attention. All the kids are getting attention. I also find that kids are working in small groups collaboratively on their own, more in the classroom. And I'm also able to do more formative assessment with each student in the classroom.
So do you have like a chart for each student and you fill it out? Each student has their own, you know, progress report, so to speak?
Yes, and I'm working towards kind of perfecting that or you know, making that a little more detailed than I have right now.
And does that information go on with them into the seventh grade year, or have you not gotten that far?
I haven't thought about that. So I know, you know, the seventh grade curriculum revisits a lot of the concepts that are introduced in sixth grade. So that's certainly, you know, helpful to the seventh grade. Yes?
I know in the past there's been some questions about, well, not questions, the certainty that depending on which school or which teacher the sixth graders had just come from, that their level of competence in math was different, and I'm wondering if you've noticed that, or if that's something that has been addressed.
That's not something that I've been able to determine.
So you don't know?
No, I don't know. Yes, Ms. Hanks.
Are you able with? I like that what you're doing. It sounds great. But to differentiate enough where you feel like you're getting the support to help the students who are struggling the most, and that you're able to differentiate with the students who are achieving.
Exactly. That was my frustration, was I didn't feel like, you know, I was teaching to the center or trying.
Yeah.
I was pulling myself apart, really, was what, yeah, I was doing, trying to go in both directions. And I found it much easier to bring them together at a table, kids around at around the same skill level, around the same skill. I don't believe I've met, you know, more than once or twice with the same group of students. It keeps changing, so it's very flexible.
Okay.
And it changes with the as I introduce concepts, I suppose.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
So just in conclusion, I think the results are encouraging. There are places where we can make changes. We've identified the places where we can make changes, and we're very aggressively trying to improve the parts of our system that aren't serving kids as well as we think they could. It's going to be a process. We've put a lot of things in place over the past year, I want to say in a half, but really year. Things like a written curriculum that can be adjusted. things like a systematic way of identifying kids who need help and actually using our Title I resources to provide the help. We have about 2 full-time intervention people at each of the elementary schools. As you heard tonight, that's probably not enough, but it's more than we've had in the past. And now we have a clear way of identifying the kids who need that help. And I think the other thing that's different is we're giving them the time they need to actually have an impact. So, you know, we're not saying meet with the kids 3 times a week for half an hour. We're saying do the LLI intervention to fidelity. You know, do the 16 weeks, which I think is something like 45 sessions. You know, we're saying do the math recovery to fidelity. And we now have this whole area of supporting kids who come to us with social emotional concerns. So I think, you know, as you heard tonight, one of the principals said, if I could have only one thing, it would be a better way of supporting kids who come to us with really deep-seated social and emotional problems. This is one way of helping. This may not be, you know, the best way. I think it will get better as we go down the road and do this and revise in the future. But we're doing something, and I think that's very hopeful for the future. So that is my presentation. Yes.
So I guess my question is about the response to intervention, because I've been on the school committee for 6 years, and there's always been this question about if we want to commit resources, given that the pie never gets any larger, that you're talking about larger class sizes potentially, because you're taking teachers who would normally be in a classroom with students, and you're saying we're going to commit those resources to making, you know, you had the intervention schedule out, to making all those interventions happen efficiently, to even going farther in the screening phase to do deeper screening and more comprehensive screening, and also making sure that you follow up. I'm just, in terms of as we look as a district at the direction we're going and how helpful it can be to do that tier 2 intervention and get those kids back on track so that the long-term savings are tremendous to the system. You know, if you divert that kid or move that kid back to doing their best work in 3rd grade, you've just saved the district 9 years of even if they don't receive significant services, of tracking that IEP and having regular meetings. Even if they're doing fine, that's still a significant administrative burden. So I'm interested to hear, as the budget gets developed, sort of how this affects your thinking in terms of personnel.
Sure, if I could just respond a little bit to that. I would add, you've also changed that kid's life trajectory in terms of what he thinks about himself, in terms of his belief in his ability to do well in school and in life, which I think is even more significant than the savings to the district. But the savings to the district are important because that helps to fund more intervention. That's the way I would like to do it. And I want to be clear that we didn't take teachers out of the classroom in order to do these interventions. We've used Title I staff, who essentially were doing pull-out services anyways. All we've done is sort of organize them into the structure of an RTI model so that they're able to, I think, target the interventions more systematically and hopefully provide them with better fidelity. You know, the one thing I think that, you know, was kind of a negative cost to the district, if you will, of this was we did some screenings for kids in 4th and 5th grade, and now we're saying, you know, we don't have intervention people for you. We're using them all in K-1 and 2. So there was a loss of teacher time for that. But my hope is that as we're able to divert kids from more costly services, we can use some of the money we save there to fully fund, if you will, or to fully outfit a tier 2 intervention model.
Well, I don't want to violate FERPA, but there's a student that I know very, very well who was pulled out in 1st grade for 10-minute sessions for a short amount of time, and is now an absolutely voracious, you know, reads hundreds of pages a week. Mm-hmm. And I actually, since he lives in my house, I get to see him do that. But I mean, to me, you know, it's terrible because it's anecdotal, and it's, yeah, I'm obviously invested, but that to me was the perfect, I got a note that just said, your student is going to be working with the interventionist 10 minutes. It was very low key, small group, and it worked like, you know, worked like a charm. And as you said, it, even better if then those resources can be used for other students and help to get them back on track. So, but I think it does demand some trade-offs. If you really want, if you really want to have that system in place, then you may need to divert resources from somewhere else.
Should I call her? Okay. Laura. So it's a series of questions that teachers answer. I think it's about 20 questions. Basically, they're asking the teachers to rate their kids low, moderate, or high in terms of a number of behaviors. And then there's a scoring program that says, okay, these concern these responses either indicate an elevated or very elevated or normal or a not concerned at all level of social emotional need in one of those four domains. So there is conduct problems, emotional problems, hyperactivity, and peer problems. So the teachers answer the questions about their kids. It's part of the reason why it needs to be a little bit delayed, because you can start screening kids academically almost from the first day of school. Teachers can't really answer questions about their students until they've had an opportunity to learn them. Thank you.
And then what do you do with the
So yesterday, the counselors and psychologists got together to review data. I believe it was with principals. Correct me if I'm wrong about that. Was it with
wrong
principals?
About that.
Wrong about that.
I don't usually say that.
Okay, I know. And so they've identified kids who are in one of the four groups of possibly needing interventions and are now working on setting up the intervention groups. So my expectation is that it would be mostly school adjustment counselors who are working with kids who came out high. So if you have, you know, four kids in this class that are all identified as having problems with peers, that's a group that could use some time with a counselor to work on, okay, how do we make friends? You know, how do I express my disappointment to a peer, you know, in a way that's appropriate? And all those types of skills that can cause kids to end up developing peer problems that then become a block to learning. So it's like an academic intervention, only you're teaching them social skills.
Is this done on each one of the children?
Yes.
Every student has one of these. Starting this year is the first year?
This is the first year. Yeah.
And I noticed on the bottom it says parent, teacher, or other. Are we having the teachers do it? If they're identified, are we also sending it home?
We're just having teachers do it right now. They're, for older kids, you can't have kids answer the questions for themselves, but we haven't even thought about what this might look like at the high school yet. So we're just staying with elementary and just having teachers answer the questions about their kids.
So it has a place down here that says parent. We're not doing this.
Not doing that yet. Lisa.
I'm curious about the slide that you have up here. You said that we have a written curriculum. You were able to look at it and make some changes to it.
Not me, the teachers.
Teachers. Yes. Targeting, compressing things, if you will, so that they can try and cover more of the things right. that will be tested before the actual test takes mm-hmm. place. I'm curious, aren't we teaching sort of to standards outlined by the state for different grade levels? And if so, is the state, I mean, why are they testing things that we can't possibly have taught our students without smashing a curriculum and making teachers work really hard? And
that's a great question, sir.
I'm confused.
I kind of feel like you're asking me to answer for the state, which I don't think I can do. I mean, ideally, you would want the testing window to be as late in the year as possible. But practically, if you get into June, then you're dealing with a lot of other things that are going to interfere with testing. Field trips, class trips, you know, all that other stuff that happens. So, you know, and, you know, just compressing isn't necessarily the answer, but it's an attempt. You know, if we can, you know, having an organized curriculum at least allowed us to have the, or at least allowed the teachers to have the insight of, oh, many of the questions that were sampled very heavily were things that we taught after the test was given. So if we can just at least accelerate those ones, we might be able to have an impact. And you know, obviously this leaves a lot of room. And I said, it's not really possible to keep up with this. So I don't think we'll end up running out of things to teach in the middle of March. But I think it's a strong curricular response to a testing or an achievement problem that was identified. And I think, you know, it, to me, just shows teachers are on it. And, you know, I think I just wanted to show that to you because I'm proud of the work they're doing.
And I agree with you. It shows that teachers are on it. I'm glad to know that they're responsible for thinking of this, for trying it, and it all makes sense to me, but I can also see where an outside observer would look at it and go, yeah, they're teaching to the test. And which has been the criticism since the very beginning of MCAS, that teachers were in the classroom just teaching to the test. And I'd love to be able to reassure them that they're actually teaching this curriculum because it's important for students to know and because it's what the standards say they should learn in sixth grade and not because we're teaching to the test. But it is, do you see where my concern is?
I do. And, you know, the only response I would have to that is the standards didn't change. The only thing that changed was sort of the sequence and the amount of time that the teachers were trying to address it in. You know, and so I do think in part this sixth grade was, I believe, kind of learning the materials last year. Teachers were learning the materials last year and may have be able to get through it a little bit more efficiently this year because the second time you teach something, you know what worked and what didn't work, and you know the third time you're even better. So, you know, I think that that is a part of what's happening here too. It's not just an attempt to try to get it all in before the test comes around.
Does this same situation exist at other grade levels in another subject matter? Does the same situation where they're being tested on stuff they haven't gotten to yet in a year, does that exist at all the grade levels and in other subjects?
Yeah, so I would venture to say that teachers make decisions about the curriculum that's taught before the testing date and after the testing date with that testing date in mind. You know, a lot of the things that you know, just speaking as someone who was in that situation, you feel a lot more freer after the test is done. You know, you can address some of the things that maybe were of special interest to you or maybe were of special interest to the kids, but may not have been, you know, necessarily 100% lined up with one of the standards. I don't know if others feel that way. That's the way I felt. There's a range within the third grade. You know, I think that, you know, when I present data, I try to present it from a district-wide perspective because it's, you know, I really don't want to set up schools against each other or have them feel that I'm doing that. But I would say that
successful horizontal learning is kind of what would it be really?
I think you lost me.
Well, I'm just if horizontally. They're all about equivalent, you know, about.
So I wouldn't say that. I would say the third grade is kind of a concern in all four schools from my perspective. It's there's a range of how concerning it is at each of the schools. You know, they don't all score like within 5 points of each other.
Okay, and then also on this form that we just have of social emotional analysis, we have certain schools that have a lot higher needs than others, or is that pretty much averaged around Charlotte City?
So I would say that on that, the findings so far have been that Leeds has a little bit less of a challenge in that area, and the other three schools are very similar.
Thank you.
So, biology is so bad.
So did they just skip over the policy stuff for that?
I don't know.
There's no way.
It's first on the agenda.
Yeah, he said
it's going to get through. Supposedly, it's worth the curriculum. You're doing it?
Okay, so thank you to Dr. Provost for that presentation. We'll now move back to item I, which is a report of Rules and Policy Subcommittee. And I'll turn it over to our chair, Ms. Minnick. And I believe we have first reading and then several votes. And I'll just, we've done in the past, I'll have you introduce each one and do what we need to do with each one.
Thank you very much, Laura, for getting me prepared. She always does a great job. All right, so the first one is your first reading of physical restraint policy, which is actually called physical restraint and behavior support policy in its newest incarnation. Most of the policy that existed before has been scrapped in favor of new language, and it's actually, our current policy looks to be mostly the procedures, which really are not supposed to be policy. They're supposed to be procedures. So what you have is the policy and then an attachment that's procedures. And I guess that it would probably best be explained by Ms. Farkas. Can you come up and speak to us about it? Would you?
Sure.
Just tell, I mean, this is all the result of updates to the state regs. So, but if you can.
So I think I'll just give an overview rather than explain it in any great detail. So the state revised its physical restraint regulations in order to make them more restrictive. And previously, districts or buildings were responsible for logging restraints, and but only informing the state if a restraint was 20 minutes or longer or involved an injury to a student. And now all restraints, no matter how long they are, must be logged. All restraints must involve a report to the family, and any restraint that, I was listening so intently to that to that presentation.
Sorry to have put you on the spot.
No, it's okay. All restraints that involve an injury to the student or a teacher, you know, or any staff member must be reported to the state, as well as the state will monitor the restraint logs at the buildings. So all restraints must be logged and ultimately reported. In addition, there's a huge emphasis on de-escalation training. And so we are obligated to really focus on that area. And so that has been a big, big focus of our work over the last year and a bit. Let's see, I'm just trying to summarize anything else. The other major restriction around restraint is that there are no prone restraints allowed, floor restraints, which in the past were part of some of the different types of restraint training. They are not part of our restraint training. All of our restraint training is standing restraints. And we follow the guidelines from the Crisis Prevention Institute. Any questions about restraint? Yes.
It's against the rules of restraint.
Right. There are techniques. I actually haven't been trained this year or last year when we've been doing a lot of training, but there are ways to help keep a student standing. The whole controversy is around people who have suffocated on prone restraints. So that's really why there are some abilities to do a prone restraint in very exceptional situations, but we will not do them here.
Then I have the other question. Do we have, I mean, I'm assuming that if we have a student who's getting restrained, that they already have other services in place. But I'm wondering if do we have policy for in terms of, you know, because obviously this is a pretty serious situation, and, you know, do we have any sort of referrals or opportunity to sort of, you know, follow up with more than just dealing with restraint, but dealing with, you know, the,
oh, yes.
Offering resources to the family.
So part of the guidelines from the state are that the principal reviews the restraint log every month. In addition, and there's some conversation around students who need a lot of support and are demonstrating that through the need for restraint. And that's something in not as formalized a way, but something that we were already doing with our student study teams, but now it's much more formalized. In addition, part of the Crisis Prevention Institute, their new or relatively new protocols are that we do something called a postvention. So if there's an intervention, we are doing a postvention with that student. So we're using the opportunity of the restraint to do some learning and instruction around social skill or what the precursors were to the incident and how to anticipate that, even if it's a very young child, and what other choices they could have made instead of really struggling.
Other questions for Ms. Farkas? Okay. So this is just a first reading, so we're not actually taking a vote.
First reading, so if in looking at it between now and the next meeting you have any questions, you're certainly welcome to contact me or the superintendent, Ms. Farkas, and you know, you can look at suggestions. But this was basically written by her following the regs, and so just to reiterate, the first three sentences of the policy were what we had before. The rest of the what we had before was X'd out, and everything else is brand new and following the updated regulations. So, all right. So that's that one. That one will come back to you next month for a second reading. All right. Now then, these have already come to you once, and they're back for a vote this time. The first one is the non-discrimination policy. In this case, again, the policy was updated to comply with changes in the state regulations, in particular about gender identity, where it was added in several places, and then the legal reference cited was changed. So I would move, and the Rules and Policy Committee recommends that policy AC be approved as revised.
Second.
Any questions? Again, this is one that we had already on first reading. Mr. Moore.
Yes, I'd like to offer an amendment to change the word insuring in the second line to ensuring.
With an E?
With an E.
Okay. So there's been a motion.
Second.
We have a second. So the amendment is to just change that one language change. Any discussion?
I love it.
All right. The chair loves it. all those in favor of the amendment say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Okay, so now back to the main motion as amended. All those in favor of adopting the policy as amended, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that one is adopted, I think.
All right, the next one is GBA, Equal Employment Opportunity. Again, this one was precipitated by that same change in the regulations about gender identity. we determined that we didn't have a policy on equal employment opportunity, and so we chose to add this policy. So the entire policy is new. It's pretty short and sweet.
Okay.
So I would move, and the Rules and Policy Committee recommends.
Second.
Approval of GBA as written.
This has been a motion made and seconded by Ms. Duval. Any questions on this one? Okay, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that one's adopted.
It's just kind of odd that we didn't have that one already.
I think we've, you know, I think we've long followed the EEO regulations.
It's just odd that we didn't have that. It's so basic.
Sort of formalizing what we have as a practice. So the next policy is that one, number IJ, which is instructional materials. And I don't know if you have the original version where you can see what the changes are. In the second paragraph, it said, it previously said, because instructional programs and materials are of great importance, only those that meet the following criteria will be approved by the committee. We took all of that out and just say, staff should ensure that materials meet the following criteria, because we don't improve, the school committee no longer approves instructional materials. Back 100 years ago when I started on the school committee, we actually did approve textbooks on two readings. We no longer have that responsibility, so saying that we would approve them made no sense. So it's now changed to say that staff should ensure that that. And then down in number five, we changed to add gender identity, and we changed sexual preference to sexual orientation. In number four, we actually eliminated a lot of stuff about diversity and development in the United States and throughout the world, and just said that we wanted to develop and foster an appreciation of diversity, period. So those were the changes to that one, as well as the mass law that's cited. That was the changes to that. So did I move already? I moved.
No.
And the Rules and Policy Committee recommends approval of instructional materials policy IJ.
Second.
As presented, as revised.
Okay. It's been a motion made and seconded. Any questions about this one? Hearing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So that one's adopted.
Okay. And finally, we are to public gifts to the schools. And frankly, I don't remember. Have we done one reading here, and then it was sent to the city because it has to do with their, we were tying this to their amount. Is that correct?
You have one reading and it came twice for a vote. One time the vote was deferred, the next meeting, and the second time, and when it went back to the
Okay.
And it was over the issue of material gifts.
Okay.
And the council has since adopted a an order deferring to the school department to accept gifts of 10,000, real property gifts of 10,000 or less.
Great. All right. So everybody understands that. The other changes that were in the originally recommended policy were that it should have, the superintendent can accept educationally appropriate gifts, and also that principals will be able to accept some gifts of certain amounts, and that at subsequent monthly meeting, regular monthly meeting, you'll have a report on what's been accepted.
So principals can get some gifts from the PTO or just in general?
Yes. No.
Just the PTO.
Again, I thought it was just the PTO. Yes,
that's what it says, but
yeah.
I misunderstood what you said afterwards. So
no, but it just says that any gifts that are accepted by the superintendent or the principals will be reported to the school committee at a subsequent meeting. That was the change, because it used to say on a regular basis.
Okay, any questions about this policy?
Actually, is that true? when we originally presented to you, it did say on a regular basis. Then there was an amendment made.
Right.
Is that approved?
I think so. It's crossed out.
There are dates here that say some amendments were done, so I think that it was approved in May to say subsequent regular monthly meeting. So based on that, the amended policy is coming back to you now that we've had the city council say that that we can accept this stuff. So once again, I don't know, was there already a motion on the table to approve this?
Let's just move it again, just to be safe.
No, there wasn't.
Previous time. Okay, I move and the Rules and Policy Committee recommends approval of policy KCD, public gifts to the schools, as revised.
Second.
Any discussion?
Which I just wanted to notice that, so we've been given the authority to delegate this responsibility up to $10,000, and we are simply doing it up to $1,000. So we are, we have room to play in the future if we decide we want to change this limit.
True.
I don't want to.
Okay. All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. So that final policy for tonight is accepted. Any other report from the committee? Okay.
I don't think so.
I'm hoping you've updated all of our policies before we leave. So everything's
all we'll have to see about order. That. I think every time they have to look one up, they find some other thing that needs to be fixed.
So, okay. So the next item on the agenda actually had been scheduled for a vote, but we're not actually going to have a vote this evening. This is regarding the authorization with regard to the construction of a modular office building for Parks and Rec. As you may know, the City Council approved last Thursday night the final piece of funding for us to move forward with creating a new space for the Parks and Rec Department. One of the locations we've been looking at is the JFK campus, as well as some other locations. We did have an opportunity, actually today, myself and Central Services Director, to meet with the superintendent, as well as Principal Wilson, and tour the campus and look at some potential sites and rule out some others. And now we want to have an opportunity to have our design team actually do a little bit more due diligence as to the feasibility of them, with everything from zoning and utilities and all that. So we're not quite ready, but we were putting this on there in anticipation if we were ready, because we have a tight timeline to make this happen between now and June. So potentially between now and your next meeting, there may be an opportunity to bring something to Budget and Property to discuss, and then bring something back to you at a meeting for some kind of approval or not. It may be we may end up not being having to be dealing with a school property. Again, we're still studying that. So that's just an update, and this may come back to you at a future meeting. Does that represent
absolutely
things well? Okay, good. Just want to make sure.
You can tell him if he's wrong.
No, I'm going to establish that as one of tonight. If you had anything else to add, that's all. So the next item is a vote. This is the private school LEA approval. And this would be a vote that would encompass the schools that are listed: Clark School for Hearing and Speech, Lander Grinspoon Academy, Montessori School of Northampton, New Directions School, and the Smith College Campus School. And I'll turn this over to...
I just want to say, for anyone who is not an educator, you can't answer, what does LEA stand for? Does anybody else know?
Local education.
I said you're a teacher. You don't get to answer. Yeah, okay. So it stands for local education. Authority, is that right?
Agency.
Local education agent.
So I'll turn it over to Dr. Provost.
Sorry.
Thank you.
It's just one of those.
So let me get the right legal reference. Under Chapter 76, private schools may not operate in a jurisdiction of a school committee without the annual approval of the school committee. I believe the essence of the process is really notification so that the committee does not find itself in the position of having schools operating under the radar in their local community. So on an annual basis, we request that all of our local private schools complete the paperwork for annual approval, which basically describes the nature of their services and students they serve. We've received completed applications from the Clark School, Lander Grinspoon Academy, Montessori, New Directions, and Smith College Campus School, and I would recommend that the committee authorize them to operate for another year.
So make a motion to approve them. Can we make the motion now and discuss?
Sure, yeah. I thought you were going to just move to approve what Dr. Provost just laid out.
I was going to vote to approve the private school approvals of the five schools. Is that what we have there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Yep. Okay, is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Any discussion on this?
Well, I just want to clarify for not only myself but for the public that all of these schools are already schools that are in existence. We're not authorizing any new schools. They're already here, and it's just our annual, we can let them do it again next year kind of thing. Yes.
My question is, what would happen if we voted no?
Right.
I don't know. I've never seen a school committee do that.
I'm just curious. It's an odd
impression in my experience.
It's an odd situation that.
Let's vote no. Let's see.
I'm curious what the extent of the law is, but it's fine. We can talk about it. Yes, Ms. Fallon.
My only question was, so I noticed one at number 12, the question was, 13, do you intend to provide special education services to students in service? And some of the schools answer yes, and some answer no. Once we answer no, are they not accepting students with special needs? Or are they, I know that some of these, I think, send them to the public schools.
So
special services. So, and so how does the money for that work?
You have two different types of schools, broadly speaking, on this list. The Clark School for Hearing and Speech and New Directions School are state-approved private special education programs. They are authorized specifically to provide special education services to kids and have completed all the requirements to be approved by the state to do that. The other three schools are just private schools with no special education mission. They are not under any obligation to provide special education services because only schools accepting public funding come under the requirements to provide special education.
So if their students need services, do they come to the public schools then?
That's one of the ways that services can be provided. Sometimes they can be provided by consultation. Sometimes students might remain enrolled, but then come to the public school to receive services for a portion of the day. There are a number of different options that are available, but in the case of a private school, that it's not a private special education school, the students still are able to obtain services from the community in which they reside.
Okay,
thank you.
Okay.
So if we did say no, I mean,
I'm sorry.
Yeah, I know. I mean, it's we can't really say no. I mean, we're worried about sending our kids school of choice and everything else, and then yet we say, okay, sure, let's have all these private schools right here. We could get a lot of our kids back if we just said no.
Yeah, I don't think we're improving their existence or their charter or their anything like that. I mean,
we're improving their existence.
But I'm saying the two schools you mentioned that are state-approved schools, those have received approvals from the state.
Tax dollars aren't going to these schools.
Yeah. So we.
So what are we approving then?
We're saying their instruction is equal to that that's provided by the public schools.
Well, I think we're just acknowledging. We're acknowledging that they're operating.
We're aware. Jurisdiction. Yeah. And right. What happens if we say no?
Okay. So have we? Someone made a motion on this. Member Duvall has. Yeah. Someone seconded it. Please. Okay. It's been seconded. Okay. Any further discussion?
No.
Very all good. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Any abstentions? Okay.
I abstain.
Okay, we have one abstention. The next item on the agenda is a vote authorizing the negotiating subcommittee to begin discussions with NACE concerning successor contracts. And did you want to introduce this or?
Sure.
Okay.
So I was copied on a October 1st letter to the mayor in which the president of NACE requests to enter into negotiations for Unit A, teachers, counselors, and nurses, Unit B, administrators, Unit C, ESPs, Unit E, clerical workers, Unit F, custodians, and Unit G, cafeteria workers. My recommendation to the committee would be to authorize this negotiating subcommittee to enter into that process.
Okay.
Is there any D?
I believe D, maybe Smith. Smith.
Which wouldn't be part of
negotiations,
yeah.
Got it.
Ms. Stackenshaw.
My concern is that I'm a member of that committee, and I don't think it makes any sense for me to begin negotiations for one meeting.
Yeah. So as chair, I'll probably be working to try to find someone to replace you on that committee. I mean, we'll be reappointing committees in January. Already, so I'm not sure what the meeting schedule would be. May ask you to be part of that meeting in December. I'm not sure, and then we'll because of, we're about to reappoint all the committees, so we can talk about that. But I'm cognizant of that fact that you're short, so we wouldn't want to start that.
Okay. Can I make a motion then to authorize negotiating the subcommittee to begin discussions with NACE concerning successor contracts?
There's been a motion made. Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Wait, no discussion.
Do you have any discussion?
No.
Would you like to discuss?
Let's go ahead and railroad that through.
What if I voted against it? Say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, so that motion is accepted, and we will begin that process through the negotiating subcommittee. Next, we have the business manager's report.
Yes, we've got four items this month. You've got your regular monthly budget report, and I did go through and highlight seven areas in particular where we've got some concerns, probably three major ones where we've got concerns about the status of the budget, and we are doing an in-depth review right now to see if we can identify funds to be transferred in particular into the special ed area where we've noticed some deficits. So we are continuing to work on that. Upcoming, I gave you a report anticipating we probably are also going to have a deficit in our unemployment account, and I've given you some background in the report as to why that appears to be occurring, things that happened after the budget was voted. Good news in number three, Angela Rota did receive notification from the federal government that we've been approved for just over $32,000 in E-rate funding, which was actually money that came to us as a result of the capital projects we did for the Wi-Fi at the elementary schools. It appears that that money, when it comes in, will go into the city's general fund, and after free cash is certified, hopefully the city council and the mayor will appropriate that money back to us so that we can make more technology purchases with that. That probably won't happen until January or February. And the last item is, I gave you plenty of nighttime reading. The end of year report to the Department of Ed was filed on October 30th. I've given you some of the summary reports that automatically are generated after submittal, so you can look at that. And then there's a few additional reports I put together summarizing some of the numbers for you. So happy nighttime reading.
Thank you. Okay. Any other questions about the business report? Superintendent report.
I just had one question about the 240% increase on, I think it's Medicaid services.
Sure.
Yes.
It's giving it.
That seems like an awful lot. I mean, is that because we are just getting them reimbursed? We haven't filed them? I mean, is
it's the amount that shows in our budget is an estimate of what our costs will be to the billing agent for our claims. So as our revenues that go into the city are increasing, the 10% fee we pay for billing goes up accordingly. So we don't know what that's going to be for the year, but based on what was spent last year and some of the increases coming in the Medicaid program, we're anticipating it's going to be higher this year.
Will you pay 10% for billing?
We pay 10% of the revenue back to the billing agent.
Is that normal?
Yes.
Okay.
no way we can negotiate that down a little?
It's actually come down from where it was a few years ago. There's only, I think, probably two billing agents in the state that really work with school systems.
The only other way for us to have a lower rate is to go directly through UMass Worcester, which would essentially mean another half-time clerical person to do that work that we're paying 10% for.
Got it. Thank you.
Okay, so now on to the superintendent's report.
Thank you. I'll try to be as brief as I can given the hour, but it is the end of a sports season. And the commissioner made his recommendation concerning next generation of MCAS public today, so I'll have a little bit to say about that as well. So earlier today, Commissioner Chester made his recommendation that we go with MCAS 2.0. All along, the thought was that either we were going to, the choice before the Board of Education would be to remain with MCAS or to adopt PARC. A new option, which is the option that is being recommended right now, is that we go as a state to MCAS 2.0. For districts like ours that have chosen to remain with MCAS, the expectation would be that we continue to give MCAS this year, unless the committee takes an affirmative vote to switch from MCAS to PARC. The MCAS that we will be taking this year, if we choose to stay with the current regime, will be an MCAS that is embedded, enhanced, I don't know what verb you want to use, with items from the PARC test, so it's sort of a semi-MCAS, quasi-PARC test. So as you can see, PARC has kind of a favored status here, even though the recommendation is to not do PARC. If you can change from MCAS to PARC, but you can't change from PARC to MCAS. MCAS will have PARC questions embedded, but PARC won't have MCAS questions embedded. Because the recommendation came out just today, I haven't had time to discuss it in any meaningful way with our school community, but I know I speak for many when I say that there are concerns about the amount of time students are spending in statewide assessments. For me, I think this is going to be an important issue for the committee to consider. MCAS is an untimed test, but it has fewer grades involved in the assessment. PARC is a time test, but it has more grades and subjects involved. I haven't seen any data on whether the fact that PARC has a limitation on how long students may take it offsets the fact that there's more grades and subjects tested. But the time limitation raises problems in and of itself. Many people are concerned, I think rightly so, with the fact that many students receive extended time as accommodations as part of their Section 504 plans or IEPs. There is an extension of time under PARC, but it's a predefined extension of time. So that's problematic in its own way. So my strong feeling at this time is that staying with MCAS for another year would be better for our students and more in line with community values. But I'd like to verify it with checking in with faculty and parents before making a recommendation to the committee. The board doesn't vote on this until next week anyway, so it may be that the question is taken out of our hands in the case that MCAS or PARC wins and MCAS 2.0 sort of goes down the tubes.
PARC requires that students do take the test via a computer. MCAS was a paper and pencil test for most students. Would MCAS 2.0 be a paper test still?
My understanding is that it'll be electronic.
So either PARC or a new hybrid MCAS is going to create a burden for us because we probably don't have technological capabilities to provide all students with access at this point in time, do we?
So it really depends on how the MCAS 2.0 is administered, if that ends up being the state's choice. One of the things about the PARC that's different from MCAS is because it's a paper and pencil test, MCAS needs to be taken all on the same day. park because it's an electronic test, and every version of the test is unique, can be given over the course of weeks. So we've heard a lot tonight about technology and access to technology. I think if MCAS had the same, if MCAS 2.0 had the same kind of lengthy window for assessment that the park has, that we probably would not have problems with technology in administering the test. If it was the same type of a test as the current MCAS is, where every student in the tested grade had to take the test on the same day, then we could be running short on machines. I think my bigger concern about electronic assessment is just that it is, I think, qualitatively different from the way that many students take their typical assessments in classes. One of the things we know from other types of accommodations that students are provided is you don't want to introduce the accommodation only for the test. It should be something that the student is used to doing. So, you know, one of my concerns is the difference in taking an online assessment from the typical assessment that students take. For me, that would be more of a concern than whether or not we'd have the technology to be able to provide kids access to the test. You're welcome. So, more to come on that in future meetings, I'm sure. As I said, we've gotten to the just about end of our fall season, and I'd like to congratulate the teams that distinguished themselves. Boys soccer qualified for postseason play for the first time since 2012. They finished 7-9-3, and they're graduating 9 seniors this year, so it'll be interesting to see how they do next year. Girls soccer qualified for postseason and were the regular season Curtie Fielding League champions. They finished 11-6-2 and are graduating 7 seniors. Field hockey qualified for postseason featuring a heart-stopping semifinal game versus Minichog. They won in overtime and saw Long Meadow in the Western Mass Finals for the third year in a row. They lost 3-0 but played an outstanding game and represented NHS with enthusiasm. They are graduating 6 seniors. Football team is still in action as they play Putnam High School on Friday in Springfield and will host East Hampton on Thanksgiving at 10 a.m. They are currently 4-5 and graduate 8 seniors. The girls and boys cross country programs finished their regular seasons 5-1 and 8-0 respectively. They both went on to win the PVIAC championship at Stanley Park last weekend. 4 male athletes placed in the top 25, including a first place finish. 8 female athletes placed in the top 25, including a 5th place finish. Both teams will travel to Stanley Park again this weekend for the Western Mass Cross Country Championships, 1 p.m. start. They will graduate 7 boys and 3 girls. The golf program struggled this year, but 2 of our athletes are named to the All-Star team, 1 male and 1 female. The team will graduate 2 seniors. The highlight of the cheerleading season was the pep rally, which took place at the end of Booster Week. They practiced a dance stunt cheer routine for weeks and showcased all their hard work and skills at the rally. They'll be graduating 3 seniors. I'd also like to take some time to congratulate our early childhood team on obtaining reaccreditation from the National Association for the Education of Young Children. NAEC examined more than 700 pieces of evidence provided by our teachers and early childhood director who's with us tonight. Our program earned commendations for using ongoing systematic formal and informal assessment approaches to provide information on children's learning and development, promoting the nutrition and health of children and protecting children and staff from illness and injury, enjoying and supporting a teaching staff that has employing and supporting a teaching staff that has educational qualifications, knowledge, and professional commitment necessary to promote children's learning and development and to support families' diverse needs and interests, for working with families, for establishing and maintaining relationships with community agencies, and finally, for administering a program efficiently and effectively, ensuring that all involved persons, staff, children, and family are included. I included a 7-page summary of the reaccreditation in your packets and would encourage you to take a look at that because it really goes into detail to all the good things that our early childhood team is doing. It really is a daunting task. It is on par with a high school accreditation visit, and it is a great, I think, statement to the commitment of our early childhood educators, and I just wanted to congratulate them on that. And continuing in the line of congratulations, we have a little show and tell tonight. I just wanted to share with you all Ms. Minnick's Lifetime Achievement Award. You may have seen it on Twitter. You may have seen it on Instagram. But it certainly was the highlight. You've been hearing a lot about Hyannis last week, and we did all attend good sessions. But for far and away, the highlight of that event for me was seeing Ms. Minnick honored by her colleagues from MASS and MASC for for a long time service to the Northampton Public Schools and its students. So, congratulations.
Thank you very much. And thank you to the chair and the vice chair and the rest of the committee for nominating me for the award. I very much appreciate your respect. So, thank you.
Well deserved, mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay, so that concludes the superintendent's report. I just want to report that we have a couple of future business and meeting dates. The superintendent evaluation team meeting will be November 16th, 2015 in the superintendent's office at 4 p.m. And then our next school committee meeting is December 10th, 2015 at 7:15 p.m. here in the JFK community room. We do have an executive session planned for this evening. And I wanted to verify the way we have this written, we're planning to come back to adjourn. Is that the plan? I think we, well, at least that's how we have it.
I don't think we, I think we could just announce now that
fine.
We'd be adjourned.
I just wanted to make sure what the intent was. So we do have that, and I would ask if the vice chair would make a motion on that.
Make a motion, request for an executive session in the JFK Principals Conference Room under Massachusetts General Law, open meeting for the approval of executive session minutes September 10, 2015, Chapter 30A, Section 21A3, to discuss strategy with respect to litigation, civil action number 14-30113-MGM, whereas an open session will have a detrimental effect. Further details would compromise the reason for going into an executive session.
Second.
So there's been a motion made and seconded. I now ask for a roll call vote to go into executive session. For members, again, the vote would be yes to go into executive session or no, not to go into executive session. So I'll ask the clerk to call the roll.
Ms.
Lawrence?
Just a reminder. Yes. Ms. Ann Hennessy?
Yes.
Mr. Downing Meyer?
Aye.
Mr. Howard
Moore? Yes.
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 Yes. And so now I have to announce publicly that we will be moving into executive session because to have the discussions we need to have, an open session would have a detrimental effect on our reasons for going into executive session. I also want to announce to the public that we will adjourn directly from executive session and will not return to open session. So with that, we can now move into executive session.
That's a wrap.